in the first quarter. It was in the second quarter, my fault.
So
the first 2 minutes of the second quarter.
So certainly a defensive battle there at this point. What have you seen from the offenses? Has either of them shown any sign of life at this point?
They try to run up the middle, and the defense was stopping them. And the Redskins had a drive going at the 30, the Hornets' own 35-yard line, but three plays, the next thing you know, and a penalty, and they're punting. So it's just basically been a stalemate so far. And you know, it's going to be. There's a rivalry, too. So, you know, this is going to be right to the end, you know. Hornets lost to them first time in 8 games, 21-0. That's the first time Hornets been shut out since 2010. So, but the Hornets are defending champions, so they like, hey, do it again.
Brian, I wonder, in a scoreless game, do you think that favors either team in particular?
I mean, favors the Redskins, but the Hornets, they battle tested. They average a one loss per season, so hey, this might be the only loss.
Kirtland's a team that historically, Bryant, has wanted to run the ball. They weren't able to do it in the first meeting against Cuyahoga Heights. Because of that, have they been trying to throw the ball more?
No passing. They running.
Good
contest right now.
All right, so that game, scoreless in the second quarter in Solon. Bryant, thanks
even
so much.
Even we got the player of the year, Brett Lohler,
yep,
the quarterback from Redskins. He can't get anything done against this Hornets defense.
Hey, they always say defense wins championships, and one of those defenses is going to prevail and win a Region 21 championship tonight. Brian, thanks so much. We'll check back in with you in just a little bit. We talked about Cuyahoga Heights' defense in that last game, them not allowing Kirtland across midfield until the third quarter. They've got a stout defense. Does this surprise you that this is scoreless into the second quarter now?
No. No, it really doesn't, because I think both these teams kind of pride themselves on that side of the football. Kirtland, you know, one of those teams, they run like 6 plays, and they're still impossible to stop. But Cuyahoga Heights has seen all those
plays, and
has had to stop all those plays in the past as well. So it's no surprise to me that this is a low-scoring game. I mean, it was 21-0 last time. For Cuyahoga Heights, 21 points is not really that many points for them. So you can even make the case that that was kind of a low-scoring game.
They know each other so well, and you talk about Cuyahoga Heights held Hillsdale to 7, shut out St. Thomas Aquinas. So this is what they've done all season long. As much as we talk about their offense and their player of the year, it's the defense that has been the staple for Cuyahoga Heights. And if you talk to their head coach, that's the first thing that he's going to bring up is that defense and how good that defense has been.
All right. Well, we have passed the top of the hour, so games moving on into the second quarter. We're sort of getting a feel for how they are playing out. A long way to go, though. We are here with you all night long until 11 o'clock. We'll come back. We'll update you on some scores, take you around the state. You're watching Friday Night Huddle on cleveland.com.
Just as athletes need proper sleep for optimum performance, so do fans. To be your best, you need your rest on a properly fitted mattress from Mattress Warehouse. A good night's sleep on the right mattress prepares you for whatever the day throws at you. Visit Mattress Warehouse for a custom sleep assessment, and we'll help you find the right mattress for a great night's sleep and a productive day. Sleep like a champion, play like a champion with the perfect mattress from Mattress Warehouse.
The best thing Tri-C did for me was give me opportunities. The workforce program prepared me for the career I have now. I got a job in the aerospace industry where I work on CNC machines. I have 3 younger brothers. I want to teach my brothers, you know, hard work actually pays off. Come to Tri-C. It's a great stepping stone to wherever you're trying to get to in life. My name is Chris Grooms, and I got my start at Tri-C.
Saturdays, after the big game, Time Warner Cable Sports Channel is Ohio's destination for all things college football. Join Les Levine and Anthony Lima as they break down all the day's action. Listen in live on Coach Urban Meyer's news conference and take your calls on the road ahead for the Scarlet and Gray. More sports and Les Levine postgame. Saturdays after the game on Time Warner Cable Sports Channel.
I'm Stipe Miocic, world heavyweight champion for Nature Stone, and Cleveland's first hometown champ. Fighting can be brutal. So can mold, mildew, or flooding on your basement carpet or tile. Get Nature Stone and never replace your basement flooring again.
Hurry, act now. Get Nature Stone and save up to 50%. That's up to 50% off authentic Nature Stone flooring.
Nature Stone, like me, simply the best.
Act now. Call or visit naturestone.com today.
Football fans, huddle up. Friday nights are about to change forever with Friday Night Huddle. From pregame to postgame and everything in between, Friday Night Huddle is the place for Ohio football action. Combining the resources of cleveland.com, Classic Teleproductions, and Time Warner Cable Sports Channel, Friday Night Huddle gives you unprecedented coverage. You can be part of the action, get updates as they happen, on cable, online, and on point. Friday Night Huddle. Dominion East Ohio is proud to salute young people in our area who work toward their goals both in the classroom and on the field. We're proud to serve our community and are committed to making a difference. Each year, Dominion partners with schools throughout the region and the entire country to develop new programs aimed at strengthening math and science education in our schools from kindergarten through high school. For more information about our programs, services, and community involvement, www.dom.com. Dominion, it all starts here.
The Ohio Lottery's Partners in Education program has been recognizing students and teachers who shine both in and out of the classroom since 2007. To nominate a deserving teacher or student, go to ohiolottery.com and click on Supporting Education. Students in kindergarten through 12th grade are eligible to be academic all-stars. K through 12 teachers can be honored as the Teacher of the Month. Every school that participates is eligible to be honored as the School of the Year. The Ohio Lottery's Partners in Education, where stars shine.
Tuesday nights are for Ohio college football. And now, Time Warner Cable Sports Channel is teaming up with your favorite site where Ohio State fans gather, 11 Warriors. Join Marissa Cotapelli and the pros who know the team best as they preview the week ahead. 11 Warriors Report, Tuesday nights at 7, only on Time Warner Cable Sports Channel.
Marching band is a non-competition band. They save everything for their Friday nights so they can perform just as well.
Thanks, Krista. Appreciate it. You see Warren G. Harding up 7-3 over Hudson there in the second quarter. A couple scores. We started to talk about some of the games down south. LaSalle in Division II, a 24-7 lead right now over Miamisburg. You know, the first couple times or the last 2 years that they won state titles, they were the number one seed. This year, they're a number three seed, so certainly coming at it in, from a different spot. Also, Sycamore, St. Xavier, we started to talk about that game. Sycamore, the 7 seed, with a 7-0 lead over St. X. St. X was 5-5 in the regular season. They're a number 5 seed, mainly because they played the toughest schedule in the country.
That's a really good football team. And we got a chance to kind of follow along with their game against Coleraine last week, especially at the end of it. And, you know, they lost to Coleraine in overtime during the regular season. They avenged that loss in overtime last week. And Coleraine, I think a lot of people felt, I believe they finished number 1 in our Super 25 at the end of the regular season. A lot of people felt maybe they were one of, if not the favorite, to win the Division I state title. So St. Xavier to win that game in overtime, avenge that loss, man, they looked really good doing it.
And them being down early is not all that surprising to me because I think there's a Coleraine effect there. In the NFL, when you play against the Seattle Seahawks, it takes you a while to recover because they're so tough, they're so physical. It takes so much out of you mentally and physically in that kind of game. And for St. Xavier to go into that game against Coleraine, put all that prep into it. Coleraine was a team that a lot of us felt like had a real chance to win the Division I state championship game. Then it goes into overtime. It's an emotional win, and physically it takes a toll out of you as well, and it takes you a little bit of time before you actually recover from that game. So I think St. Xavier going into tonight is the better team than Sycamore. They're more battle-tested, but I'm curious how long it's going to take them to physically recover from that overtime win against Coleraine.
Look, the fact is when you play in that GCL South and you play that tough of a schedule and then you come up here and play the powerhouse in Northeast Ohio every year, you are certainly battle-tested by the time the playoffs come around. Would be interesting, though, if we could see a number 7 seed advance to the state Final Four. All right, one game that we've been keeping our eye on all night long is Olmsted Falls and Anthony Wayne. Let's head out there and see how that one is shaping up. Anthony Wayne got out to the early 7-0 lead. Olmsted Falls bounced back, but this is Anthony Wayne's Nick Schneider getting into the end zone from 5 yards out, and Anthony Wayne, the Generals, take a 21-7 lead.
Nick Schneider, really good. Rushed for 197 yards and 3 scores in the first half against Glenville to open the playoffs. Last week, 30 carries, 161 yards. So no real surprise that he's kind of been carrying the load for Anthony Wayne tonight.
Again, two teams that want to run the ball, and that's Anthony Wayne saying, look, we think we do what we do better than you do what you do. And it's just been ground and pound. It's been tough, physical, everything in the trenches. And it looked like, once again, Olmsted Falls didn't even touch the running back on that one, just physically overmatched on that particular play.
Dropping down by 14 points early, yeah. Certainly not a hole that they want to get into there. Meanwhile, we talked about the Big Red and the Whippets. Yep, Steubenville, Big Red on the board first as they get a touchdown to move ahead 7-0 over Shelby in that Division 4 game there. As we take a look at the Big Red, like they might be doing it with
a quick pass out to the left.
Pass out to the flat and then just let the receiver do the rest right there.
And get into the end zone for that 7-0 lead. But there again, another low scoring game in the second quarter.
You see so much of that with, you know, spread offenses, even for teams that aren't traditionally spread offenses. You use the horizontal passing game a lot, where you try to get one-on-one matchups, get the ball to guys in space. And you have the quarterback kind of on the move on that play as well, so it gets a defense kind of out of position, and all the guy has to do is catch the football and beat one guy, and it looks like that's what happened on that play.
All right, last we checked that St. Ed's St. Ignatius game, that game was tied at 7. We saw St. Ed's tie it up with a nice long drive there, so we'll certainly continue to keep tabs on that game as we move our way across the state. About 8:15 here on Friday night, regional final Friday. 16 games in total. It's divisions 1, 2, 4, and 6 all playing tonight. Of course, Division 1 this year made the switch from Saturday night to Friday night. Aaron Goldstein, Chris Feeder, Dan Lobby, thanks for joining us on cleveland.com. And of course, if you're looking to watch some football, make sure you turn over to Time Warner Cable Sports Channel, as we have live games there all across the state. And then, of course, their audience will join us as those games start to finish up. We look out on them. They look in on us as we get to the end. Great little partnership.
It's not as creepy as it sounds.
Anything stick out to you guys?
Leave it to you.
45 minutes into action here so far. What have you noticed?
Well, I love that St. Edward was able to respond against St. Ignatius. For Olmsted Falls, falling behind, we talked about that. Not a good thing for them. Those are kind of, and you know, we've seen Lynn Bowden make some plays too. So that's. Those are kind of the three things that I look at and say, all right, let's keep an eye on how those things play out over the rest of the night.
Yeah, and I think the other thing, obviously, is St. Xavier going down. St. Xavier is a team that once you beat Coleraine, all of a sudden you start having state championship aspirations, no question about it. And for them to be down, again, it just goes back to, okay, how much do you have left in the tank after that kind of game that you just played against Coleraine? Sometimes a state championship is won by a team that had the most clear path to the state title game and didn't have to expend so much energy in the early rounds. Now, sometimes those early rounds and winning those games, that's going to help you a lot. But a lot of times it's, did you have a clear path? Were you able to get past your competition easier than the other team?
You know, the guys out in Steubenville must have heard me. I said it was a low-scoring game there. It didn't take long for another touchdown in that one. Let's head out to that game and check in as it's a 15-yard touchdown. This time it's Shelby tying things up. That's Armstrong to Gessler, the lefty, into the end zone, and we're tied at 7. Or excuse me, that's Steubenville. as that game now tied at 7 there in the second quarter. So that one, a back and forth affair.
Always have to be able to respond. That's what you want to see out of a football team. When you fall behind, can you turn around and respond? Like we talked about with St. Edward, that's the important thing in the postseason, is you don't want to let things snowball. You're playing good teams. They're going to score on you. They're going to make plays on you. You've got to remember that you're a pretty good team too, and you can do the same thing.
All right, so that game tied at 7 as we continue to follow games all across the state. We heard we got the update earlier from the Kirtland Cuyahoga Heights game. That game at that time was scoreless in the second quarter, so defense supreme there. Seems like defense has been supreme in a lot of places all across the state. We continue to follow those games as they continue to happen. And then we go, you get to this point in the season, mm-hmm. and you realize that, hey, we've put in all the work, all those camps back in the summer, and the two-a-day practices, and then fighting through the cold weather, which we haven't had a ton of this year. And this is a time where you got to make all that work pay off.
Yeah, it's really about execution, too. Mm-hmm. It really is. I mean, which team is going to execute what it is they want to do best? And it's going to be about turnovers. It's going to be about special teams. But you can go into a game with a plan, and that plan's going to work until you get punched in the face. And then how do you respond to that? But really, it's about all these things that you've prepared for, and you have these trick plays, and you have these two-point conversions, and you do all of this work, but can you execute in that particular moment? And that's what it's going to come down to, and that's what it's been so far tonight.
And we've talked about it as the season's gone along, too. Sometimes when you lose a game, that can be good for you, too. Not now, but as these teams have gone through the season, when they face losses.
Right.
Look at Xavier. Right. What did they learn from those 5 losses, especially that loss mm-hmm. to Coleraine? And it gives coaches kind of an opportunity to get their kids' attention a little bit. I think Stowe was a good example when they lost to Hudson earlier in the season. It gives a guy like Mark Norrie a chance to say, all right, guys, we've been cruising for most of the year. We got to get right on some things. And they were able to turn that into one playoff win, and then they came close to pulling that upset against St. Edward. So, when you lose games sometimes, it can be a good thing. Like you said, until now, you don't want to lose now. There's no teaching after you lose it this time of year, but during the regular season, those things can help you.
That's the other thing that stands out to me. If you notice, which games are the ones that so far have been the closest? It's been St. Ed's, St. Ignatius. It's been Kirtland, Cuyahoga Heights. It's been the teams that know each other. They've seen each other. So there's not as much of a shock factor involved. St. Ed's played against St. Ignatius. They felt the physicality. They felt the toughness. They saw that offensive line up close. Kirtland, Cuyahoga Heights, they've played against each other. They know what they're trying to do. They have felt that power. They have seen that misdirection. When you have that familiarity, that's going to give you a little bit of an advantage. Whereas if you're seeing a team for the first time, again, you can prepare and you can think that you're ready, but you go out there and you're like, wait a minute, you're a lot faster than we thought you were. Wait a minute, you're a lot more physical than we thought you were.
The other thing, too, is how someone responds when you kind of punch them a little bit.
Yep.
So maybe you watch somebody on film and you say, all right, that guy's pretty tough. And then maybe you go against him, punch him in the mouth a little bit, and maybe he backs off a little bit. Maybe you find a little something or a little trick that might work. So there's a lot of little nuances you can pick up because you've played someone previously.
And you mentioned that St. Edward, St. Ignatius game, no longer tied. Let's check in for a little update there. Chris, you may want to turn away. Matthew Trickett. No one got into the end zone. Matthew Trickett getting Ignatius the lead with that field goal there. Makes it 10-7 in favor of St. Ignatius. Wildcats on top.
Ignatius can always kick the football.
Yeah,
seems like
right?
They always have a really good kicker. And what I love about Chuck Kyle, that wasn't a long field goal, but he likes trying long field goals because his philosophy is in high school football, you kick a long field goal, it goes in the end zone, it comes out to the 20. You don't get it at the spot. And he's never afraid to use that rule against his opponents a little bit. He likes to take chances.
Speaking of field goals, let's go the other direction, trying to tie the game, and it is blocked. So the Wildcats coming up on special teams with a big play. That was Mason Waller's field goal, and the Wildcats able to penetrate through the line and block it. So this one stays a 10-7 game.
Can't make mistakes. Nope. Talked about that. You can't make mistakes against this team.
Oh, I got whiffed. 87. Connor led him right around the end.
And that was Connor Kennedy able to come up with the block there. Went straight in. Ryan Rockwell unable to make the block for St. Edward as the Wildcats will take the ball back. As you mentioned, ball didn't go into the end zone there. So in that case, it doesn't come out to the 20-yard line. You always hear about it. It's not just about offense and defense. Oh. It's about special teams. And we see the field goal made for Ignatius, the block run for Ed. Could be a pivotal turning point.
Especially when you talk about two teams that are close matched, or at least you believe are close matched, and two teams that know each other so well. Sometimes special teams can be the difference. Maybe it's a kick return. Maybe it's a punt return. Maybe it's a great punt that gives you great field position, or maybe it's a blocked field goal. You saw a swing right there. I mean, these two teams are so close, and some of these games between the two teams have been decided by such a tight margin that blocked field goal could end up becoming the difference.
All right. Well, we will, as always, continue to keep tabs on this game throughout the night. But we have got to go back to Solon. Last time we checked in with Brian Kaiser, the game between Kirtland and Cuyahoga Heights was scoreless in the second quarter. They have reached the half now. Brian, what can you tell us?
Like you say, we are at halftime, and the Redskins are up 7-0. They had a big drive to close out the first half. They started from their own 10-yard line. Then a 22-yard slap pattern to Dylan Drummond, who got away from the defender into the end zone for the touchdown. With the extra point, they lead 7-0.
What you feel like maybe sparked the offense after the defense really stood tall through the first quarter and a half?
Well, Brent, they stopped going on the ground. They started throwing the pass at half. And you got the Division 6 player of the year and the quarterback, Brent Lawler, and just let them throw the ball. And that's what they're doing. They're getting some passes played, good passing, good catching. And that's the difference between this game right now. I guess the coach, Al Martin, say, hey, let this kid throw the ball. We got a pretty good receiver in Drummond. And let's see where we go. And they got the score back. And now Kirkland had a football to start the second half and see what Kirkland is going to do.
Brian, when you look at this passing game all of a sudden, do you think it's something that Cuyahoga Heights can sustain into the second half? Or was it kind of a one-time thing that they were able to get Kirtland on?
You know what, Tiger, the head coach of the Hornets, going to bring out to them. This is, they got one more half to go then. And Cuyahoga Heights, the Redskins, they want this game. They want to finally really put it to the Hornets. The Hornets been running the D6 school for a long time. It's now time for the Cuyahoga Heights Redskins to say, hey, we belong here too.
Brian, what's that atmosphere like there? Obviously, the two teams meet in Solon in the regular season. They met on, in Kirtland there. What's the atmosphere been like there tonight?
Well, Kirkland's fans are stunned right now. They thought he was going to go into halftime 0-0. And mostly it have been 3 punts and out. Then they had an interception. They had some, stops. But they just cannot run the ball.
All right. Brian Kaiser at Solon tonight. And we will check back in with you in a little bit. 7-0 Cuyahoga Heights there as they have reached the half. Guys, when you look at it, they've now played 6 quarters this year, and the Redskins are up 28-0. Does it shock you a little bit?
Well, Dylan Drummond has become really a reliable playmaker for the Redskins. The junior had a 40-yard interception return in Week 11 in the win over Hillsdale, and there he is making the big touchdown catch in this game. So Cuyahoga Heights, their weapons have kind of shown up for them so far in these two matchups, and Kirtland so far have not, but you never know with that Hornets offense.
Boy, Bryant said something there at the very end that you just don't hear very often when talking about Kirtland. Kirtland can't run the ball against Cuyahoga Heights, and maybe it's going to change in the second half, but that's what Kirtland does. That's what Kirtland has done throughout the last 6 years, I would say, is they feel like, okay, everybody knows that we're trying to run the ball, and nobody's going to be able to stop us. It's kind of the Chardon mentality, and that gives them a psychological advantage on the other team. But for Kirtland to not be able to run the ball in the first meeting against Cuyahoga Heights and not be able to run the ball tonight so far against Kirtland, number one, it speaks volumes about Cuyahoga Heights' defense. And number two, Kirtland's probably saying, okay, where can we go? It's not like they can turn to the pass. All right, our run is being contained, so we're just going to throw it in the hands of our quarterback and he's going to toss it all over the yard, because that's not who they are. That's not how they win state championships.
But let's say this about Kirtland. They can throw the ball just a little bit. Dylan Folco, 6 of 11 a couple weeks ago for 95 yards and two scores. That's a big night for a Kirtland quarterback.
You're right about that.
And Palmer Capretta is their big receiver. So if Kirtland is going to win this game, it might be because we hear those two names.
I feel like we have to adjust expectations when talking about certain things.
It's all relative.
They can throw the ball a little bit. 6 completions in one game, Chris. Take that.
Maybe not about how many you have, but when you have that.
That's right.
It certainly comes in big. One half to play. There. Well, we told you earlier that Anthony Wayne jumped out to a 21-7 lead over Olmsted Falls. The Bulldogs not going down easily. Let's take a look in on the action there as Olmsted Falls tries to respond, and they do just that. A long pass play. That's from Brett Hutke. 63 yards into the end zone for the touchdown. Makes it 21-14.
And you saw the misdirection there, and you saw everybody that was loaded in the box. Anthony Wayne was thinking, run, 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 certainly going to happen. They bring everybody up there to slow that down. They bring a guy in motion to find out what the coverage is going to be and say, you know what? We've got an opportunity to get behind the defense because everybody on the defense is within 10 yards of the line of scrimmage. When you have those opportunities, your Olmsted Falls, that's why we talk about execution. They probably had that one dialed up. They're feeling great about it. You have to make that throw, and kudos to Hutke because he did.
Yeah, like we mentioned, no pass attempts last week. The week before, 429 total yards, 377 of them were on the ground. So this is a team that does not often go to the air, and it's good to see that they were able to execute in that situation.
Again,
in the passing game.
Like we talked about, it's not necessarily how many.
That's exactly
but
right.
If you can maybe pull a little, deception and fool them there, it certainly turns out in your favor.
So I mean, Hutke probably goes into a game thinking, I might get like 5 to 10 passes, so I have to make the most of them. I can't miss. If he misses that pass, who knows? It's a completely different game. But he hits that pass. Now all of a sudden, maybe the defense is thinking, wait a minute, we've got to worry about his left arm a little bit too. Maybe we're going to start to drop some guys back. Maybe that opens up holes for Spencer Linville, and that could change the complexion of this one.
You know, it's sort of like a Hilliard-Davidson type team.
Exactly right.
Midway through the season, had not thrown a pass at all. I often wonder really what goes through student athletes' mind when they say, hey, I'm going to go out and try to be a wide receiver for that team. Yeah, you're going to go and block. And,
right.
But,
you might want to transfer if you're a wide receiver.
But they have them there, and you never know when they could come in handy, just like they did for Olmsted Falls. All right, back to that St. Ignatius, St. Edward game, Holy War Part 2. Let's head out there. We have an update. Last in we checked, it was 10-7 St. Ignatius, and the Wildcats adding to their lead. As they get into the end zone, the quarterback keeps it for the touchdown.
And he did that in the first meeting against St. Ed's, that dual threat capability. And that's something that makes him so effective. St. Ed's can feel like, hey, look, we've got really good coverage, or we've slowed down Bobinski. Then all of a sudden, Patrick Ryan starts to use his legs. He picked up a huge first down in the first meeting between the two teams where he ran for about 20 to 25 yards. It's that dual threat element that St. Ignatius has not always had. They've had the traditional drop back passer. Not like Brian Hoyer was running anywhere. It's not like Ragone was running anywhere. It's not like Mark Myers was really running anywhere. They have Patrick Ryan, a dual threat quarterback, who gives St. Ignatius a different kind of dimension offensively.
And now that it's a 17-7 game, do you sort of start to see St. Edward have to change the style of play that they got so they don't let this game get away?
I don't know if you have to change your style yet. I mean, that's sort of what you have to avoid, I think, in this situation, because it is only 17-7. It is only a 10-point game. And you don't want to panic. Like, if it gets to 24-7 because maybe you started to play out of character and maybe you did panic a little bit, that's when you're really in trouble. So I think the approach still needs to be get the football back, try and put together another strong drive like you did in response to that first score, try and get this thing to 17-10 or 17-14, and just go from there, because 17-7 is certainly not something that St. Edward can't overcome.
Especially, Dan, because if you go back to that previous drive, St. Ed's had a field goal blocked, but they still got in range for a field goal. So we didn't see the game, but they were obviously able to move the ball effectively enough against St. Ignatius. So it seems like their offense has been working. Their defense, on the other hand, has not been working, giving up 17 points. in the first half against St. Ignatius.
All right, last time we checked in on Warren G. Harding and Hudson, it was a 7-3 game in favor of Harding. Well, the Raiders back at it again, and Lynn Bowden back at it again. Let's head back out there and check to see what he is up to. Is they get close to the goal line, and then Bowden able to find Hooks. That's Jalen Hooks, a 2-yard touchdown, and the Raiders have opened up a 14-3 lead.
And there's Lynn Bowden saying, take that, Chris. You say that I want to run the ball. You say that I'm most effective running the ball. Well, take that. There it is. They faked the handoff. The defense had to honor that running game. The defense had to honor Lynn Bowden running the ball. And he threw a nice pass for a touchdown.
You almost can't defend him in that situation because you know when you're that close, he can run it in.
Right.
But then in that situation, too, that's an easy throw. So it's a really difficult spot to have to defend that guy.
You know when they're on the sideline, Bowden's got cleveland.com dialed up there on his phone. He's watching you.
That's exactly right.
All right. Well, the Eagles get the ball back. And have they responded? Let's head back out to Bedford to see what's going on in that game. 17-7 there. St. Ed's looking to get back in it as we pick this one up live, last 30 seconds of the second quarter.
Just 28 seconds left, obviously. Yeah. Got to have a sense of urgency. They do have a couple timeouts. Here's your downfield throw.
Ooh.
That'll do.
Dropped it in the bucket. I mean, exactly where he had to throw that. If that's a little bit underthrown, that's a pick. That's Cordell Hoover, too. A big play receiver for St. Ed's.
Then it's a touchdown that really just completely changes the dynamics of this game as we head towards halftime.
Yeah, and I'm curious what St. Ignatius will do here now, because there's a little bit of time left.
Yeah.
You know, it looked like they had timeouts left, so I'm curious to see if they're aggressive or if they're willing to take a 17-14 lead into the locker room.
That's a different feeling for Chuck Kyle, because it looked like, the first time we saw it, it looked like maybe St. Ignatius got the ball first. Not sure about that 100%, but I mean, you're Chuck Kyle, you're feeling great, you just get that touchdown right before halftime, and you're saying, all right, we're going to go into the half 17-7, we can regroup, maybe we force a 3-and-out, or we go down the field, and we can start to distance ourselves a little bit. Now St. Ed's getting that huge play, now you're talking about that blocked field goal being the difference between these two teams, and if St. Ed's can get something going early on in the third quarter, it takes on a completely different complexion.
Did that deep look maybe catch Ignatius by surprise a little bit?
Like, I mean, he certainly got behind the defense. Yeah. Though. He certainly got behind those defenders, and there were two of them. So he beat his man, and there was a safety or someone who wasn't where they needed to be. So I am curious if maybe they were expecting one thing and got another.
Look, Kevin Kramer admitted that after that regular season game that he had nerves. Playing at First Energy Stadium in front of 18,000 fans.
Sure.
Now you get a chance to sort of be back in a much more normal high school atmosphere, probably about half the crowd there than there was at First Energy Stadium. You know, a lot of to me, it's great to see him actually admit that, because a lot of times you'll see players say, oh, no, it didn't affect me. Look, it's a different atmosphere trying to play at an NFL stadium.
And the other thing, too, the environment, like you said, the stadium is much smaller. I think Bedford only seats maybe 5,000 or 6,000.
Right.
So the stadium's a lot smaller. You're kind of in that big First Energy Stadium, even with 18,000 people. It's kind of a strange, hollow sort of environment there. So there's a lot of people, but maybe it doesn't feel like a lot of people. That could be a strange environment to have to play
in. And it's also nerve-wracking playing St. Ignatius, especially for Kevin Kramer, a guy he didn't play last year against St. Ignatius for varsity. He didn't play the year before that against St. Ignatius. This was his opportunity. This was his first chance to play against St. Ignatius. And if you go to St. Ed's, and if you grow up on the west side, in the Lakewood area, the West Park area, you grew up saying, I want to beat St. Ignatius. I want to play St. Ignatius. And that was his opportunity, his first opportunity. And sometimes you look across, and you see Chuck Kyle, and you see the paw, and you could be like, oh boy, there's a little intimidation there, especially when you are getting your one shot against St. Ignatius. So I do like the fact that he was willing to admit that. And not only that, Aaron, but the fact that he saw that. He got those nerves out of the way. He got that jumpiness out of the way, and now he's got a second shot against St. Ignatius. If you're at St. Ed's, sometimes you only get one shot at St. Ignatius. He's getting number two, and he looks like, so far, trying to make the most of it.
Right, a lot of players at St. Ed's don't get that. These two teams have only met. This is the third time in the playoffs that they've met. St. Ignatius won the first two meetings. St. Ed's trying to change that there. We're going to change directions here, move back to Division II, to the Olmsted Falls-Anthony Wayne game. That game has reached the half. Let's check in with Tim Bielek, who's on the phone with us now. Tim, what's the update there?
Well, it's been a game of two running football teams. As we expected, Anthony Wayne, 28, Olmstead Falls, 14 and a half. It's been that two-man committee of Nick Schneider and Evan Brown that have combined for all four of the Generals' touchdowns. And that Anthony Wayne offense has been absolutely outstanding. Olmstead Falls really hasn't had an answer for defensively other than that one takeaway. But the Bulldogs do get the football back to start the second half. They've been able to make some plays, particularly with some uncharacteristically good passing, big plays in the passing game. So they have a chance, but they have to figure out a way to slow down this red-hot Anthony Wayne offense.
Tim, Anthony Wayne's a team that in the playoffs so far this year, they've put up 21 points in the first round, 14 in the second round, and now they're at halftime. They've got 28 points. Have they been doing something different offensively?
Well, they're definitely getting blockers up front. And most of the plays, they've had six linemen or six guys up in front of the line with a tight end or another blocker in the box. And right now they've actually run, just got the stats, for 345 yards as a team. And it's Brown and Schneider who have all 345. Brown going for 215, Schneider for 130.
Tim, how is Anthony Wayne doing something that nobody's been able to do so far in this postseason, limit Spencer Linville, a guy who's a man amongst boys out there?
Well, they've been able to key on him a little bit. They forced the only punt of the game. And it's tricky to try and take one guy in a way in a triple option. Linville does have 41 yards on the ground. Olmstead Falls has rushed for about 113, about 110 so far, but really it's just come down to that one key stop, and then each team has gotten a turnover, and it's just been a matter of the fact that Anthony Wayne has not punted. They scored on four of their five possessions, and the fifth one they got the ball taken away from them. So the Generals' defense has been very good, no doubt about it, but still a lot of football left for Olmstead Falls trying to get back into this game.
Tim, you mentioned Olmstead Falls has turned to the passing game a little bit. They didn't throw the ball at all last week. What has the passing game looked like? What have they kind of done to try and get that going in the rare instances where they have thrown the ball?
Well, depending on how much you watch triple option football, say your Navies, your Georgia Techs, they will throw from time to time, and it's been plays where Rod Hudke, the quarterback, has dropped back. It's looked like option plays. You always see a back usually motion towards one side of the field. They've faked it to Linville, and then for the touch, the big 67-yard is Josh Jakin. Jakin just got behind the defender, and Hudgate just put it on a good spot for it to make the play.
All right, Tim, appreciate it. Well, it is 28-14 there at the half. We will certainly check in with you throughout the night. Let's move down now to Division 4. Last time we checked in, Steubenville and Shelby, that game was tied at 7. They've reached the half now, and Jeff Sabo is there. Jeff, what's the update from that game?
Oh, hey, how you guys doing tonight? It has been a fantastic atmosphere here at Paul Brown Stadium. The Steubenville Big Red up 15-7 over the Shelby Whippets. Steubenville, with less than 30 seconds to go, ended up getting a touchdown when Johnny Agresta took a fumble 88 yards into the end zone. The Big Red put on a two-point conversion, and that's how we ended up with a 15-7 score here at halftime.
What have you noticed from each team? It seemed like it took a little bit for each team to be able to get on the board. Now Steubenville's offense is getting going. Have they sort of hit their stride?
It really kind of seemed like it took a lot longer for Steubenville's offense to really get going. Jacob Bernard, their running back, he seems to be getting a lot of carries. He's had some good carries so far. However, the Shelby defense has stopped him in the backfield a couple of times, and there have been a lot of opportunities for Steubenville to pass the ball and move the ball down the field that way. However, Javon Davis, some of his throws have been off, and there have been some opportunities where his receivers have dropped the ball. And had they been able to catch some of those passes, they would have been able to extend some drives, and we might have been looking at a different score at halftime.
Jeff, Shelby's a team that is not used to being in the postseason. Steubenville very comfortable in the postseason. How do you feel like Shelby is handling the environment and the step up in competition?
Well, talking with their head coach, Eric Gawill, before the game, you know, he was very relaxed. He definitely stressed that they were going to be very enthusiastic about this opportunity to be in the playoffs. And then their quarterback, Brennan Armstrong, he's a Division I recruit. He looks very relaxed in the pocket. Nothing really shakes him. He's been able to extend a lot of plays. he's got to be their leading rusher so far here tonight. There have been a lot of opportunities where you would think he was going to go down and get sacked, but he would end up running 6 to 7 yards up the field, and he's had a couple of good pass plays as well. So Brennan Armstrong really being a leader on offense for this Shelby team and making the most of the opportunities when presented.
Jeff, before tonight, did you know what a whippet was?
Not exactly, no. It's definitely had to look that up before I walked into the stadium. So, to be honest with you, the answer to that question would be I did not know what a whippet was.
Well, neither did we.
All right, Jeff, appreciate that, and we'll check in with you throughout the night as Steubenville looks to move back to the Final Four for the fourth straight year. They lead 15-7 over Shelby at the half. Meanwhile, another game has reached the half, Notre Dame Cathedral Latin and Perry. We've talked all night long about low-scoring affairs. This is certainly one of them. Bill Mavel is there with an update. Hey, Bill.
Hey, guys. How's it going tonight?
Pretty good. What do you got from us there?
So we're at 8-6 at the halftime. Perry's leading by two. It's been a very defensive game so far, which I think really plays into NDCL's strength. Perry's been moving the ball up and down the field a little bit, but NDCL's done a nice job of stiffening up and forcing some punts. So right now we're sitting in a two-point lead at halftime.
NDCL's been a team that's been able to pull a couple upsets to get to where they are right now. You feel like this low-scoring type of game where they're right in it is exactly what they're looking. They were looking for coming into tonight?
Yeah, absolutely. The Perry came in averaging nearly 44 points per game, so they didn't want to get into a shootout with these guys. But NDCL's defense has been averaging around 15.5 points a game again. So, slowing the game down, keeping their offense off the field, but by using this run control offense, it's really playing to NDCL's strengths right now.
Bill, what is it about NDCL's defense, though, that's been able to slow down a Perry offense that has scored 40 in back-to-back games so far this postseason?
So far, they've done a good job of keeping everybody in front of them. Aside from one long pass midway through the second quarter, nobody from Perry has really gotten loose behind them. The only drive that Perry had was actually aided by a pair of penalties, pair of defensive penalties by NDCL, a roughing the kicker. Interception was overturned on defensive pass interference. And they even had a fake punt on that drive. So it was a little bit of everything. Perry pulled out just about everything out of the playbook in order to get the ball down the field on that drive. But so far, they're doing a nice job of keeping everybody in front of them, not letting them get to the corners, not letting them get behind the safety.
Bill, both of these teams have sort of thrived on turnovers. So have we seen any turnovers in this game or anything close to a turnover in this game?
We've had a couple near misses, a couple times where balls have hit the turf and been recovered by the offense. Right towards the end of the second quarter, Perry was trying to drive down the field a little bit and nearly had a pass picked off at about the 45-yard line. So NDCL's defense really looks like they're looking for that turnover, looking for that big play right now.
All right, Bill, low-scoring game there. We'll see if who can put some points up on the board in the second half. Maybe we will have a 7 seed. Again, we're talking about that, a 7 seed, possibly moving on to the regional or to the state Final Four. Appreciate it, Bill, for the update. We'll check back in with you in a little bit. Well, there's another low-scoring game that we need to check on, and that is back in Division I. Seems to be the theme of tonight. Olentangy Liberty and Lorraine, the Titans and Patriots playing a close one there. For an update, we bring in Nate Klein, who is at the game. Nate, what's the update you got for us from there?
Hey, good evening, guys. At halftime, Lorraine is up 12-10. Olentangy Liberty, you know, the coach was really questionable about his team and the special teams. If you get a chance to check my Twitter feed, you can see a over 50-yard field goal attempt was returned for 99 yards for a touchdown by Carlos Chavez. So, again, halftime 12-10 here.
How do you get to 12, Nate? Nate, how do you get to 12 points? It seems like an odd score.
Both teams are doing really well in this game, but it's just trying to make plays. I think Liberty came down here and only had two attempts to try to put some more points on the board, but obviously they could not do that. And as far as Lorraine, they're just trying to get what they can get from the defense for Liberty.
All right.
Nate, has Liberty been able to kind of limit Chavez in the run game?
Yeah, they have. They have. You know, they've done a good job about that. But obviously, as you can see, you know, he's going to try to get his yards wherever he can, whether it's on defense or offense. So, you know, they're limiting him a little bit. But what's really kicking right now, Liberty, is that they have six penalties. And every time they do that, they always seem to turn the ball over to Lorraine. And obviously, it's not showing up on the scoreboard. But, you know, they're trying to be effective.
All right. We certainly appreciate it, Nate. And it is a low-scoring game there. We'll check back in with you in a little bit. Of course, the Patriots 10-0 on the season, but they normally put up a lot of points. Not so far tonight. Impressions where you see that score?
Yeah, well, I mean, Lorraine's a pretty good defensive football team. They're tough to pass the ball against. And look, they're just athletic. They have a lot of guys who have been really good on their basketball team. Their head coach, Dave McFarland, has been able to go and convince to play football. And that's big. I mean, if you're a good basketball player, you're pretty athletic. That means you can jump. That means you can run. That means you can do a lot of things that can make life difficult for an offense. So there's a number of guys that Dave McFarland has gone and said, hey, you know, you're good at basketball. You should come play football for me. And I think you're seeing kind of the fruits of that here.
And look, we shouldn't be that surprised about Lorraine's defense, because this is a defense that has been stout all season long. Held Midview to 29, and now I say 29, but that's Midview terms, 29. Midview, a team that usually scores 40, close to 50 points. So 29, 7 against Bedford, 13 against Cleveland Heights, 14 against Olentangy, 14 against Dublin Jerome. So this is a Lorraine team that has shown that they can win a defensive battle with those guys that Dan was talking about. And this is a Titans team that hasn't had 10 wins in a season. They're up to 10 now. They haven't had 10 wins in a season since 1930. So you know that this is one of the better teams that the program has had.
All right, won't have to go there. Meanwhile, out in Twinsburg, they've reached the half as well in Region 5 between Hudson and Warren G. Harding. We've, of course, talked about Hudson, the comeback team of the last couple of months. Are they going to need to do that in the second half? Let's check in right now with Ryan Isley for the latest in that game. Hey, Ryan.
Hey, guys, and yeah, if Hudson wants to advance to their third straight state semifinal, they're going to have to revert back to the script they've used the last 6 weeks. They're going to have to make another comeback. They trail 14-3 to Warren G. Harding as we get close to entering the second half here. And, you know, it looked early like it was going to get ugly for Hudson as they gave up a 73-yard touchdown run to Lynn Bowden on the second offensive play of the game. But ever since then, they've kind of bottled Bowden up on the ground. They've only given him 51 or less than 50 yards. He's got 122 on the day. But the big story for him is he's been hitting deep passes. He's got two passes of more than 40 yards, and he's thrown a touchdown pass. So he's been able to do it with his arm tonight when they've been able to stop him on the run.
Ryan, do you sense that that is something that has surprised Hudson?
I don't know that it's really surprised them, but the catches that Warren G. Harding has made, I got to tell you, they've been perfectly placed footballs and just great catches by athletic receivers. Hudson's had great defense on all of them. I don't think that they were surprised they were going to throw the football because their DBs have been all over the receivers. Just been great plays. I mean, there's been a highlight on almost every big play tonight. Nothing simple for Warren G. Harding on offense. This Hudson defense isn't giving them anything easy.
Ryan, our reporter that covered Warren Harding last week was speechless at halftime about Lynn Bowden. Obviously, like you said, Hudson has been able to bottle him up. But have you had any sort of, you know, wow plays from Bowden yet in this game?
Oh, I'm telling you what. When you're recording this game, I'm sitting here recording, and I'm trying to be careful not to audibly say wow. I don't want to have my voice on the recording, on the highlight, because he just does things that people shouldn't do. He's an absolute video game freak. There are plays, even the plays where he's gotten 1 or 2 yards, he's run out of 4, 5, 6 tackles and somehow gotten back to the line of scrimmage or gotten 1 or 2 yards. He makes those plays, and it reminds me a little bit of when Braxton was in high school, the way that he used to be able, he used to break tackles and run around people. He's an athletic freak of nature, and I'll tell you what, Hudson has done a great job of being able to bottle him up for the most part tonight. Other than that one big run.
What's gone wrong for the Hudson offense?
Turnovers. They had a turnover. They were driving at the end of the first half, last couple of minutes. They get a big run inside the 5, and as they were fighting for yardage, instead of going out of bounds or going down, he kept trying to fight, fumbled the ball, and Harding recovered it inside the 5 with under 2 minutes left to play. Other than that, the Hudson offense is actually it looks like they've been able to move the football. They're running crisp routes. They've had a couple of drops. They've been able to move the football. They just haven't been able to punch it in the end zone. Their first drive ended in a field goal, and since then they haven't put any points on the board. But like I said, they've been rotating all three quarterbacks. All three have been able to find success in their own way. They just haven't been able to make them pay at the end of the drive. Now, Hudson will get the ball to start the second half, so it'll be interesting to see which quarterback comes out first of all and which offense they decide to try to run here at the end of the first half, at the beginning of the second half. You would have to think they're going to try to control the football to keep Lynn Bowden off the field. But again, they're going to need two scores now to come back and tie or win this football game.
So, Ryan, if the goal in the second half is to keep Bowden off the field and control the ball with their offense, is there a quarterback that kind of plan favors more than the other of that three quarterback rotation?
I would probably say Jackson Parker is more of the running quarterback. Pelé is going to throw the football a little bit more. And then William Wallace is also a running quarterback. He's also just a sophomore. He's come in. He's had a couple series. But I would, if I'm going to try to just hold the ball and I'm going to like go for long drives and try to sustain time, I think I'm going to go with Jackson Parker.
All right. Well, we have certainly seen Hudson's ability to come back in the second half of games previously. We'll see if they can do it. Ryan, thanks so much for the update. We'll check in with you in just a little bit. All right. Well, guys, as we see all these games reach the half, is you feel like maybe it's just a lot, and a lot of these matchups where you get teams playing each other that just aren't familiar with each other, has it been sort of a feeling out process that maybe we could see something different as we head towards the second half?
It is always strange how some nights just kind of every game plays out the same.
Yeah.
You know, every game, for whatever reason, every game is just kind of low scoring and you don't have any shootouts. And that's sort of how tonight is playing out, and I think you kind of hit it, Aaron. I think it is kind of, we don't know anything about these teams except for Cuyahoga Heights and Kirtland, and that was always going to be a low scoring game, but we don't know anything about this team. We're trying to kind of figure each other out. Second half now, you get into that locker room, you talk to your guys, you make some adjustments. Maybe some things open up here in the second half.
Yeah, and for Hudson, now you know what to expect from Bowden in the second half. Now, can you make the adjustment and can you slow him down and do something that nobody's been able to do all year? Okay, maybe. Good luck to you. But at the same time, you've gotten over that hurdle of seeing it in person. We heard it from Ryan right there. He's seeing him in person for the first time, and he's saying, wow. So for Hudson, seeing it in person, they're probably thinking the same thing. Like, wow, this guy's really, really fast. Or, wow, this guy's really, really good. But now they've had an entire half to see that. And now it's up to them to try and make an adjustment and see if they can contain him. Something that it seems like, as the game has gone on, they've gotten better at.
All right, well, it will certainly be fun to see if the Explorers can hit their stride offensively in the second half. One thing we know for sure, their marching band has hit its stride. As we head to break, Krista DeFini takes us out with the Hudson Marching Band. We'll be right back.
All right, the Hudson Marching Band has taken the field. I can't wait to see what they play. They're playing a classic and a personal favorite.
Welcome back to the field, the number one band in the land, the 2016 Hudson High School Swing Marching Band.
Yeah, baby! Before I decided to go back to Tri-C to become a nurse, I was a stay-at-home mom. Absolutely wanted to be a pediatric nurse. I love taking care of kids. If you're thinking about changing your career or changing your path, go to Cuyahoga Community College. I feel like I'm in a great place in my life. I have three great kids. I have a great job that I love. I could not have done it without Tri-C. My name's Diana Geary. I earned my nursing degree from Cuyahoga Community College.
Just as athletes need proper sleep for optimum performance, so do fans. To be your best, you need your rest on a properly fitted mattress from Mattress Warehouse. A good night's sleep on the right mattress prepares you for whatever the day throws at you. Visit Mattress Warehouse for a custom sleep assessment, and we'll help you find the right mattress for a great night's sleep and a productive day. Sleep like a champion, play like a champion with the perfect mattress from Mattress Warehouse.
Wednesday nights, more sports, and Les Levine is live at 6. Then at 7, Access Crew SC. And at 7:30, High School Blitz Preview. It all starts Wednesday night at 6. Follow us on social media at TWC Sports OH. Across town and across the region, this is where fans belong. Time Warner Cable Sports Channel.
The Emmy Award-winning High School Sports Insider features Ohio's best high school sports stories. For 17 years, the High School Sports Insider has been spotlighting role model students, outstanding athletes, and the Buckeye State's best teams. In-depth features from all sports all school year long. For the best high school sports coverage, make sure you tune into the High School Sports Insider each and every week on Time Warner Cable Sports Channel.
As World Heavyweight Champion, Clevelander, and spokesman for Nature Stone, we'd like to present you with our own award.
Wow, it's awesome.
We had it made ourselves. It's made of...
Not the award, the floor.
Oh, it's Nature Stone.
Installed over concrete, Nature Stone flooring is tough, durable, long-lasting, and beautiful. Act now and get up to 50% off.
This is the only time you'll see me on a floor.
To schedule your free in-home consultation, go to naturestone.com today.
Football fans, huddle up. Friday nights are about to change forever with Friday Night Huddle. From pregame to postgame and everything in between, Friday Night Huddle is the place for Ohio football action. Combining the resources of cleveland.com, Classic Teleproductions, and Time Warner Cable Sports Channel, Friday Night Huddle gives you unprecedented coverage. You can be part of the action. Get updates as they happen. On cable, online, and on point. Friday Night Huddle.
There is a place where dreams arise. Stars are born. And greatness is made. What you live for lives here. Time Warner Cable Sports Channel.
Matt Gould for Cleveland.com and Friday Night Huddle with a halftime report from St. Ignatius versus St. Edward in the Division I Region 1 final. St. Ignatius has led throughout in this one. They are up at the half 17-14, although momentum is starting to shift to the side of the Eagles. Cordell Hoover, who had a muff punt you might have saw earlier, made up for it with a 66-yard touchdown reception in the final 18 seconds of the half. That's where we stand. But look at some stats. And this is what jumps out to me. Curtis Zalesta, 9 carries, 64 yards. I mentioned in pregame, St. Ignatius has given up just 66 yards on the ground per game throughout the season. So the fact that St. Ed's has already rebounded to get that kind of total at the half says something. Also, turnovers have been the story of this game. I mentioned Hoover's punt return. Another fumble earlier by quarterback Kevin Kramer, recovered by James Layden, led to that field goal. So that's a 10-point swing right there. And Ignatius has looked like the better team for the first, I'd say, quarter and a half, but the turnovers have really been the difference. That's the only difference in this ball game right now. So that's where we stand right now. 17-14, St. Ignatius is on top. But remember, St. Ed's gets the ball to start the first half, or the second half.
And that could be key since they have momentum. We'll see what they can do with this first drive.
All right, thanks, Matt. Appreciate the update there. 17-14 in favor of the Wildcats as they have reached the half. And as you said, Chris, the Eagles get the ball to start the second half. How big? We talked about that big touchdown pass in the last 30 seconds of the half, changing momentum. Now they get the ball back. Really a chance to change the game completely.
Yeah, for sure, and to overcome all of the mistakes. And Matt said it right there. A muffed punt, a blocked field goal, and a fumble by their quarterback. Playing against St. Ignatius, you usually don't get an opportunity to overcome all those things. So if all of that happened and they can come out and they can put a drive together here to start the third quarter, take the lead against St. Ignatius despite what happened in the first half, I mean, that would be huge, obviously.
Yeah, we talked about it before the game. You can't make mistakes against St. Ignatius. Well, St. Edward has made mistakes, and they've gotten away with it. It's 17-14. It probably should be much more than 17-14. So you take a deep breath. You say, all right, guys, first half, a lot of mistakes. Chris Fedor was over here kind of banging his head against the table while Matt was going through that list. Only a three-point game when we get the football. You kind of get a clean slate now.
All right, we talked earlier that Cuyahoga Heights had a 7-0 lead at the half over Kirtland. How'd they get there? Well, let's take a look out there as we head out to Solon. Those two teams doing battle. This is how the Redskins got on the board. It's Drummond with the pass into the end zone. Nice catch, nice cross, a slant across the middle in for the touchdown as the Redskins took the 7-0 lead into the half there. They're getting ready to kick off in the second half. We talked about the defensive battle there. It's been a defensive battle in many games across the state. Some score updates for you. Down in Southwest Ohio, St. X and Sycamore, they are tied at 7 at the break. Meanwhile, same score in the Region 3 game between Pickerington Central and Wayne. That is 7-7. Sort of a surprise there that both those teams have been held to so few points. Other updates for you. LaSalle, the two-time defending state champion, not having any problem with Miamisburg. They have a 31-7 lead over Miamisburg in that one. Marion Local, that always dominant MAC, they have a 13-0 shutout lead over Mechanicsburg. Meanwhile, it is 21-7 in favor of the defending champs from Division 4. Bishop Hartley leads Ottawa Glandorf as they have reached the half as well. The Hawks, a 5-seed this year, trying to get back to the state finals like they did last year where they beat Steubenville in the championship game. As you look at some of those scores, anything stand out to you?
I still am keeping track of that Cuyahoga Heights Kirtland score. I want to see how Kirtland responds, if they're able to run the football, or if Cuyahoga Heights maybe figured something out in that passing game. That's really the key to me, because they started throwing the ball. We saw that highlight. I just want to know, can they come out and start throwing the ball at will a little bit against Kirtland? Did they figure something out?
Yeah, I mean, I think that obviously stands out. And the other thing is just LaSalle continuing its dominance. And I think one of the questions that so many of us had coming into this postseason is, okay, who's the team from Division II, not that's going to win the state championship, but that's going to test LaSalle and find a way to get past the Lancers? And a couple of the teams that we thought had a great chance because of explosive offenses, Avon being one of them, Midview being another one in Division II, they're both out of the mix. So it opens up a lane for a team to get into that kind of showdown against LaSalle, but they continue to show, even on a night where a lot of games are close, the distance between them and the other teams in Division II, it seems to be very, very wide.
And let's face it, too, though, they are not in the same situation as the last couple of years. As dominant as they are, they're not the number one seed. They're the number three seed. They caught a break.
Right.
I don't know how they're the number three seed, but they caught a break because Troy, the number one seed, got beat by Miamisburg, and LaSalle sort of showing right now that they still are that team to beat, at least down south in Region 8. All right, let's check back in at Kirtland and Cuyahoga Heights. They have started the second half. Brian Kaiser joins us there now with an update. Hey, Brian.
Hey, the beat goes on for Dylan Drummond. He caught an 89-yard touchdown pass, and it is 14-0 to Cuyahoga Heights. 4 minutes to go in the third quarter, and the Final Four is looking pretty good. Like the Redskins are playing some good defense. The Hornets had the ball for the first time at the Redskins' 25-yard line, but the next three plays was a fumble. They recovered minus four, a false start minus 5 yards on that one. Then they got a sack. Then they had to punt. The very first play, for the Redskins was an 89-yard pass to Drummond, and it was wide open, and from the 40-yard line, he ran 60 yards right down the field to a touchdown.
Well, Brian, you sort of feel like with the way the Cuyahoga Heights' defense is playing, that 14-point lead feels more like about a 28-point lead.
It might be enough. Like I said, they're the only team that have shut out the Hornets so far this year. It's, like I said, first time since 2010. So I think they said that we'll do it again.
What have you seen so far from Brett Lowther?
Brett is ready throwing the ball now. They scrapped that running defense. I mean offense, and play action pass at Drummond was wide open. He just ran in 60 yards. I mean, the Hornets fans are shocked.
Well, we look at it, and in six of the last seven games coming into tonight, the Redskins defense has given up 7 points or fewer. So certainly a tough task the Hornets face there. Brian, we appreciate the update. We'll keep tabs on your game there. 14-0, and they get that passing game going. Pretty impressive.
Yeah, and for Kirtland, you know, a team that loves to run the football, mm-hmm. and never really gets themselves out of character, I wonder if they're thinking back to that last game a little bit. And I do wonder if maybe, look, they're not going to start throwing the ball around the yard, as we talked about, but I wonder if maybe they do start to get a little bit more aggressive and maybe see if there are some opportunities to throw the football.
And Dan, you mentioned earlier Dylan Drummond, just a guy who has emerged here throughout the postseason as a big-time playmaker offensively and defensively. When you see a quarterback, Brett Lowther, have the kind of season that he has had, sometimes the wide receiver can be overlooked. And we're starting to understand in watching Cuyahoga Heights why Lowther has been able to be as successful as he is. Yes, he's a dual threat quarterback, but he's also thrown for over 1,000 yards. Half of that went to Dylan Drummond, clearly his go-to target tonight, showing exactly why.
Guys, Cuyahoga Heights has only made it to the Final Four one time. That was 18 years ago, way back in 1998, trying to get back there tonight. All right, we talked about the comeback explorers. It's not the fourth quarter yet, but they are on the move. Let's head out there and check out how they were down 14-3 to Warren G. Harding, but Hudson making a move, and this is Kevin Callahan. Going to go right through the line. It's Hudson. Tries to get back into this game. They line up in the I formation. It's something you don't see a lot anymore, but Callahan threw the line into the end zone for the touchdown, and it is 14-10 now. Warren G. Harding still on top, but hey, here come those explorers.
It's like they've been through this before. It's like they don't blink when they're trailing anymore.
Said it at the beginning of the show. Some teams have to learn how to be comfortable when uncomfortable. And Hudson's comfortable being uncomfortable. And for Warren Harding, you got to be thinking, wait a minute. This team has come from behind week after week after week. We have to make sure that we put them away. It's not a team that's going to go away. So we have to go out and put them away.
So does it maybe make it when Hudson is comfortable being
yes.
uncomfortable, Harding is uncomfortable being comfortable because they know what's on the other side.
I would think that the pressure right now is all on Warren Harding. You know, they came in tonight. They're 11-1. They got up to a big halftime lead, 14-3. Now all of a sudden, Hudson's starting to make that comeback. I think you find out a lot about a team like Warren Harding and a lot about a quarterback in Bowdoin, how they manage this upcoming drive after Hudson just scored.
And the other thing, too, for Warren Harding, obviously when you have a guy like Lynn Bowdoin, maybe sometimes it's easy to say, he's got this.
Yeah.
You know, let's let him take care of this. Other guys are going to have to step up around him and make plays because Ryan mentioned, you know, Bowden's had good numbers in the first half, but Hudson was doing a decent job of bottling him up, at least from the perspective of how you bottle up Lynn Bowdoin. So somebody else from Warren Harding is probably going to have to step up and make some plays if they're going to hold off the Explorers.
All right. Well, Hudson, not the only team on the comeback trail. Anthony Wayne had a 28-14 lead over Olmsted Falls. But back comes Olmsted Falls. Let's take you out there and find out what's going on. It's Spencer Linville.
I wonder which one he is in that video.
Into the end. How do you stop him? That makes it 28-21. Anthony Wayne still up, but the Bulldogs back within 7 points as they play here in the third quarter, not going away easily.
The thing about Linville is he's so big, but his head coach, Tom DeLuca, and other guys that have kind of played against him, talk about his feet. He's got good feet. Like, he's not just
Dancing
a big dude.
Bear.
Yeah, he's not just a big dude that runs you over. He's got good footwork. He's a legitimately good running back.
And the thing that's hard for Anthony Wayne and every team that has played Olmsted Falls throughout the course of the season and in the postseason, you have to tackle that guy for four quarters. Maybe you can do it for two, but once you get into the third quarter and the fourth quarter, you're like, geez, oh man, this guy just does not stop. And the kind of physicality that he runs with, it takes a toll on the opposing defense.
5'9", 240 pounds.
I mean, think about that. You got to tackle that 41 different times throughout the course of a game? No thanks. I don't care who you are. You know, Nobody wants to do that.
You know, maybe Anthony Wayne wishes that this typo in the OHSAA's roster was right. It says 5'9", 24 pounds.
Yeah, exactly.
I think he's a little more than that.
We've mentioned this before, and Chris Fedor, I know you love your fast food.
Yeah.
Spencer Linville told the Lorraine Morning Journalist pre-game meal, McDouble, McChicken, fries, and if he's feeling it, a milkshake. Could you eat that, like, pre-show? Next week, can we bring that on the show and have you try and tackle that?
Look, I mean, in the Cavs locker room, it's pasta, it's fruit, it's salmon sometimes, but a McDouble, a McChicken, a milkshake? No, I wouldn't want to play a football game after all that kind of stuff. Are you kidding me?
I think that topped Wade Boggs used to eat a whole chicken before every game for he played.
It's like the high school version of Marshawn Lynch snacking on the sidelines.
Hey, got him into the end zone got Olmsted Falls back within 7 points of Anthony Wayne. We will certainly keep tabs on that game. These games, midway point really now of the third quarter. We head down the stretch run. We've been with you for the last 2 hours, 15 minutes with you until 11 o'clock. Aaron Goldstein, along with Chris Fedor, Dan Lobby. We thank you so much for joining us on cleveland.com. Of course, if you're looking for some live football, make sure you check out Time Warner Cable Sports Channel. Viewers in Northeast Ohio will get the St. Edward St. Ignatius game going on right now. Central Ohio, it's Pickerington Central and Wayne. And down in Southwest Ohio, it is Sycamore and St. X. That's 7-5 matchup down in Region 4. So these games moving along here. Some points now finally being put up on the boards. Maybe teams finally now enjoying this nice weather. We've seen teams go to the air. About a quarter and a half to go in a lot of these games. You see any team? We've seen a couple teams sort of closing the gap here. Can some of these teams actually get over that hump and make these comeback complete?
Well, you always got to keep an eye on Hudson.
No.
We've talked about them over and over again. St. Xavier is interesting to kind of see how they respond. You know, of course, they are always going to have the advantage of quarterback with Sean Clifford, the Penn State commit. And, you know, let's see how the Whippets play against Steubenville, because they've got a Division I quarterback as well, and you always kind of watch for that stuff on these warm weather nights when you get to maybe use that Division I quarterback a little bit when maybe you were expecting some cold weather and some snow to maybe neutralize that option. So let's see how those guys do.
And I think we have to give a lot of credit, guys, to head coach Jeff Goff of Hudson, because part of the reason why Hudson's been able to respond in the second half and rally in the second half and come from behind to win games in the second half is because of the adjustments that head coach Jeff Goff is making at halftime. Yes, it's execution, but you also have to put your players in a position to succeed. And this is somebody who came into the year and there were a bunch of questions about him. He's filling in for Ron Wright, a guy who's had tremendous success at Hudson. And here's a guy in head coach Jeff Goff who's using three quarterbacks. And when he said, I look at it like Ohio State from a few years ago, people probably chuckled at him. But he's zigging when other people are zagging and is working well. He believes in all three quarterbacks. He said, I want to use all of them in different ways. I look at it like a cornerback. I look at it like a linebacker. If I rotate those guys, why can't I rotate quarterbacks? So he has stuck to his guns. And a big reason why Hudson's been able to come from behind is because he's making the right adjustments at halftime.
It's a tough job to do when you know that that job's not yours.
I mean, he's filling in for Ron Wright.
And he's doing a really good job. And guess what? They're back at it. Let's go back out to the field to see what Hudson can do as they try to complete this comeback over Warren G. Harding. Just another attempt, this time perhaps turning to their defense as we head to the stadium to check in on Warren G. Harding and Hudson. That is Max Kellerman coming up with the interception there. And then that would lead to a score by Tarion Jackson. Jackson Parker, into the end zone. And Hudson, just like that, two quick scores. And they are on top. They're out waiting for the fourth quarter this time.
No. Defense, right? It all starts with that defense and forcing turnover, something that Hudson is, just does year after year. No matter who the coach is, no matter who's on their team, they're always able to force turnovers. And they had a little pressure. It was a screen pass, not a great throw from Bowden, and Hudson was able to take advantage and right down the field to take the lead.
And that's the thing that stands out to me. It was 14-3 early. It was 7-0 in the snap of a finger. And all of a sudden, you've got this explosive offense and Warren Harding, a team that nobody's been able to slow down all season long. Even their loss against Cardinal Mooney, they scored 34 in that game. So you've got a team that's been stuck on two touchdowns. This is an uncomfortable feeling for Warren Harding when they're used to scoring 30, 40 points. They look up on the scoreboard and they're thinking, we've been stuck on 14, it seems like, for 10, 20 minutes now.
Yeah, Hudson able to turn the tables there. Two quick early scores in the second half as they take the 17-14 lead over Warren G. Harding. We've talked about it all night long. The comeback kids trying to do it again here tonight. Last we checked, it was 17-14 in favor Ignatius as they started the second half there. And we're going to head out there live, about 3 minutes to go in the third quarter. Still the same score.
Look at all that time.
Yeah. Well, that's pretty throw, too.
Yep.
Right where it needed to be, in stride. And Aaron, you were asking, you know, can Patrick Ryan do it through the air just like he can do it on the ground? And you saw it right there. Part of the reason why he can do it through the air is because he's got all the time, he's got the weapons, but he also makes passes like that. He did that in the first meeting against St. Ed's. He did that in a few playoff games so far this year. So, yeah, he does seem to be the complete package, running and throwing.
Talked about the mistakes, and maybe it wasn't a turnover, maybe it was just a three and out or something, but missed opportunity to come out of the half with the football and not score, not take that lead. Now you gave St. Ignatius a chance to go back up by two scores against you.
Look, and this for St. Ed's, you know, in the second half of the first meeting between the two teams, St. Ed's mustered like 60 yards of offense or something like that against St. Ignatius's defense. So that's where you start to talk about the coaching. That's where you start to talk about head coach Chuck Kyle. And now you've got St. Ignatius up by 10. You know what they're doing. They're going to pin their ears back. They're going to bring the pressure. And they're going to try and force St. Ed's into more mistakes. This is not the position that St. Ed's would want to be in.
Obviously, they were able to stop St. Ed's when they got the ball to start the second half and then able to score. But right back down the field on the other end, this is St. Ed's trying to get closer. It's 24-14, 10-point game as they play here late in the third quarter.
It's obviously a good response by the Eagles. Now they're driving with a chance to get back to, you know, you would hope 24-21, but even if you get it to 24-17, you know, you're coming up on that fourth quarter. And when you get to that spot, sometimes all it takes is, you know, an interception or a fumble.
Yeah.
It can take one small thing to give yourself an opportunity in that final 12 minutes.
Look, we saw it in the first half. When Ignatius scored, St. Edward able to bounce back right away and get that answer. They're looking to do the same thing here.
Whew, that's a heck of a run.
That is quite the run there.
Curtis
Zaleska into the end zone.
It's just patient, like, got behind his line. Yep. Followed him into the end zone.
So we've certainly seen that St. Edward can get it done following a St. Ignatius score. Now the trick is for them not to let St. Ignatius score and be able to get it done and take the lead as they bring the game back within a 3-point lead.
And that blocked field goal. That blocked field goal
you feel
early
like those
in the first half.
Always
you feel,
come back to haunt you, don't you?
You're right about that, Aaron.
All right, down in Southwest Ohio, we talked about Sycamore St. Xavier, the possibility of a 7 seed making it to the state final four. Well, Sycamore, late in the third quarter, now has a 21-7 lead over St. X. So perhaps a chance for the Aves, who are making their first appearance in the regional final, to knock off a perennial power. Certainly would be a signature win for them as they look to advance. Meanwhile, it was a low-scoring affair between New Albany and Massillon Perry, 10-6. They are into the fourth quarter there. The top seed Perry from Massillon up 10-6 over the Eagles from New Albany, 11:52 or so to go at last check there in the fourth quarter. We continue to move on throughout the state. Hitting the fourth quarter, guys, now.
And look, Sycamore is a team. They beat Mason last week, a team that was in our Super 25 for a little bit. They played against Coleraine earlier this year. They played against LaSalle and took LaSalle into overtime in the first game of the year. So this is a team that has played against the competition that they're seeing tonight against St. Xavier. And we talked about how much that can be beneficial. And maybe their record in the regular season was not what they wanted it to be. They probably didn't get the seed that they wanted it to be. But because they played that kind of schedule and because they played that kind of competition, they're not going to see that X on the helmet from St. Xavier and be intimidated in the way that another team is going to be. They've got some signature wins and signature matchups on this schedule that is certainly seeming like it's helping them tonight against St. X.
And you mentioned earlier about the St. X maybe having a little bit of a hangover after that win last week.
Takes a toll.
Not being able to come out and get off to a fast start, which allows a team like the Aviators to say, hey, we got a shot against this team. They're not coming out and just running away with this game, and now they've got a lead and a chance to pull an upset.
Obviously, though, don't count out the Bombers. No. They're a team that we saw last week against Coleraine, able to come back late, and they forced overtime last week and eventually won it. So Bombers, certainly with plenty of experience, Coach Steve Speck always has that team in a good position coming down the stretch. So they're 21-7. I mentioned Perry up 10-6 over New Albany there. Meanwhile, it's 7-7 still between Pick Central and Huber Heights. They're still only at the half. That game might take, we mentioned one game might be over by now. This one might be going to about 11:30 at night.
How was a 7-7 game only at half? That's what I want to know.
Of course, the viewers in Central Ohio can watch that game right now over on Time Warner Cable Sports Channel. In the other Division I game that we haven't done a ton of talking about, Olentangy Liberty and Lorraine going at it. What have you guys seen from that game so far?
Defense of Lorraine, the defense that has carried them into the postseason, the defense that has been the staple for them. They lost two games to start the year, and then they got into the kind of defense that you're going to have to play in order to be a playoff team. You talk about a team that held Bedford, very explosive offense that was scoring about 30-plus points per game, to just 7 points. Cleveland Heights, with all of their playmakers, a wide receiver that has Alabama, Ohio State, all those big-time programs on his list. You hold Cleveland Heights to 13, first two postseason games, 14 and 14. So when you can play that kind of defense, you don't need as much from the offense. And Lorraine's not a team that's going to go out there and score 30 or 40, but they don't have to because of that defense, Dan.
And again, there's such a great story. I mentioned it with Deshaun Brooks and Naz Bohannon.
Mm-hmm.
Deshaun Brooks, who's one of the best corners in the area, he started playing football last year because Dave McFarland went to him. He said, pretty good at basketball. Why don't you come try this football thing too in the fall? Just don't worry about basketball in the fall. You can start playing that after we're done trying to win a state championship. And he's a great story on a great team because now he's getting football offers from MAC schools. A couple of Big Ten schools have come calling for him. So when you have a great corner in high school football, it can be game changing for your team because you can take the number one receiver out of the game from the opposing team. And some of these schools that have great number one receivers, maybe there's not a lot of depth behind that guy, and it changes how the quarterback approaches the game too.
Another score they were keeping an eye on in Division IV, the defending champs, Hartley. They had a nice little cushion there, but now Ottawa Glendorf coming back. That game 28-21 in favor of Bishop Hartley. They have about 11 minutes to go in the fourth quarter there. So that game getting close. A lot of these games getting close as we come down the wire into the fourth quarter. It's playoff time. It's when all those big moments seem to happen. Certainly be fun to see as they unfold here on regional final Friday night here in the Buckeye State, third week of November. Of course, tomorrow, three more divisions get their games underway. 3, 5, and 7 will get going tomorrow night. The change from previous years where Division I moved to Friday night. As you look ahead to Saturday, is there anything that maybe strikes your eye at all, strikes your fancy in the games coming up tomorrow night?
Hoban is always interesting just because I think they're such a good team, and they're coming off that rivalry win against St. Vincent St. Mary 21-7. So how do they respond against New Philadelphia? Is there, we talked about that hangover with St. Xavier. So is there a little bit of a hangover there with Archbishop Hoban? Obviously, everything is settled with Danny Clark. He committed a few weeks ago, so there's no questions there. They're kind of settled in and focused on trying to win another state championship. But, you know, you kind of keep an eye on them against a new Philadelphia team that, you know, that's not a bad football team. Hoban is going to be the better team going into that game, but the Quakers can make it a tough game.
Yeah, and Toledo Central Catholic, I don't know that they needed a break. They don't ever need breaks, but Sandusky losing last week, a lot of people were looking at maybe a Sandusky-Toledo Central Catholic matchup in the regional final. Now all of a sudden it's Lexington against Central Catholic. So we talked about do you have a clear path into Columbus and Central Catholic? Again, nothing's easy when you get into the postseason. There's no question about that, but an easier path for Toledo Central Catholic.
Dan mentioned the game between Hoban and New Philadelphia. Northeast Ohio viewers will get to see that on Time Warner Cable Sports Channel live tomorrow night. Meanwhile, the rest of the state will see the game between Trotwood and St. Mary's Memorial. Guys, a little bit off the field here for a second. The big news this week or the past couple of weeks, of course, the Big Ten announcing that they're going to move some games to Friday nights. A couple days ago, the Ohio High School Coaches Association coming out officially saying that they are against that move. They're joining coaches associations from several other states in announcing that opinion. Your thoughts as the Big Ten gets set to play games starting next year on Friday nights?
Oh, and we've also seen a couple Big Ten schools say, you know, no thanks, we're not going to do that. And that's what the Coaches Association would like to see Ohio State do. I don't really understand the move by the Big Ten, to be honest with you, because that's such a big program. The money is flowing in. When you look at MAC schools and you look at some of the smaller schools that have moved to the in-week games, it's to get exposure. Mm-hmm. It's to get TV time, recruiting time, things like that. The Big Ten doesn't really need that. And the other thing, the point I thought the Coaches Association made that I thought was good was it hurts your recruiting a little bit because now your coaches maybe can't attend a game they would have attended. You know, maybe they can't, you know, they're going to see a kid eventually. I mean, it's 2016. You can see a kid if you want to see a kid. But you're not maybe going to get that in-person view that you might get.
I agree. I mean, one of the edges that the Big Ten has had on some of these other conferences is exactly what Dan mentioned. They're recruiting. Michigan's being able to recruit at a high level right now. Ohio State, of course, recruiting at a high level right now. And I think the other thing is you're taking some shine away from some of the kids for so long, especially in this area. And I know we're biased because we're talking about this area, but for so long, Friday night has been about high school football, Friday night lights. And you're taking some of that away from the kids, kids that you want to bring to your program. And Dan's absolutely right. This is the Big Ten. You're the Big Ten. You're not the MAC. You know, you're not the WAC. You don't need these kinds of games midway through the week. Just control Saturday. Take a stranglehold of Saturday. And I just think it's an oversaturation of what's going on, and it's trickling down from the NFL into college right now.
What we've certainly seen is that the conferences will follow the money trail.
Right.
Not necessarily that I agree with the move, but I will say that you look at it, it's not like Ohio State's going to be playing every Friday night.
No.
It's once a year, maybe. They're not going to have a home game until 2018. So it's not like it's going to be the spotlight off of high school every Friday night. It'll just probably be one or two, you know, in the season as it goes on.
But I think there's also a chance that the quality of football decreases because you have less time to prepare and you have less time for your body to recover. Somebody said it from the NFL last night after the Carolina Panthers played against the New Orleans Saints. They're talking about player safety this, player safety that, and they're asking us to play 3 days after just ramming into each other for 60 minutes a game. I think you want the quality of football to be at its best, and I don't think you're getting the best quality when you're asking these guys to play on a Saturday and then turn around and play on a Friday as well. That one extra day could mean a lot for bodies and preparation.
All right, let's get back onto the field, head back into Division Four. Head out to Mentor. That's where Bill Mabel's spending his night. The game between NDCL and Perry. Bill, what do you got for an update?
Hey, guys, we've reached the end of the third quarter. We're still sitting at 8-6. Perry's leading. NDCL finally got a turnover inside Perry territory, but couldn't do anything with it. They tried a 56-yard field goal, and it had the leg, but pushed a little wide right. So that's where we're sitting right now.
Wow, point tough to come by there. So much so that you're trying 56-yard field goals. What's been the tough part for both these offenses?
You know, it's really been sustaining the drives. We played a lot between the 30s and they get a little bit closer into the scoring areas. The defense has really stiffened up. For NDCL, we've had a couple of really big wind-aided punts that have flipped the field position for them. Ryan LeBanc has boomed a couple big ones. One was 67 yards, one was 70 yards. It really turned over the field, so making Perry march the entire length of the field in order to score.
It's rare to see 50-plus yard field goals, but Bill, Notre Dame Cathedral Latin, they've tried a lot of those. I would think in this kind of close game, 8-6 game where special teams could play into it, NDCL having that kind of weapon where they feel like if they have to go to a 40-plus yard field goal, I would think that that would change some of the things that they do from a schematic standpoint, no?
Yeah, absolutely. The drive where they tried the 56-yard field goal, you can see they went a little conservative on second and third down because they got themselves into long situations due to penalties and a couple negative plays, and they seemed content to say, you know, we'll just try the long field goal because we know he's got the leg to make it. So it'll be interesting to see the fourth quarter, though. NDCL will be kicking into this strong wind, so we'll see if that affects the play calling.
All right, Bill, we appreciate the update there. 8-6 heading into the fourth quarter. We will certainly check back in with you in a little bit to see how that game finishes out, the Division IV game coming down to the wire there. A lot of games coming down to the wire as we hit it towards the fourth quarter.
When you have low-scoring first halves, 24 minutes in that second half, unless there's a big difference between the two teams and it just comes out in the second half, you're usually going to have pretty close second halves. And that's what you want in regional final week, right? I mean, that's you want close games. This is one of those weeks where there's just so much on the line. You get a trophy at the end of the night. You want it to be a hard-fought close game, at least from the outside looking in. I'm sure the players would love to have a 47-0 blowout in favor of themselves. But I'll take a bunch of close games.
Hey, you know what? We're going to go back to Bedford. There's a little game going on there between a couple teams that might know each other a little bit. St. Ignatius, St. Edwards, and this game has changed up a little bit. Let's head back out there live. We'll check in here. It's 24-21 Ignatius. That changes.
It's Melvin Jackson.
That is Melvin. Look at Melvin Jackson. Whoa, look at Melvin Jackson. No one can take him down. Sets up Edge pretty good there early in the fourth quarter, trailing by 3 points.
Throw under pressure and a great job by the secondary to just have a nose for that football, an underthrown ball with the hit coming. And Melvin Jackson, nose for the football, goes and gets it.
And he's been their playmaker on defense. They haven't made a ton of plays. They certainly didn't in the first meeting against St. Ignatius, but he's that guy that has stepped up and made plays defensively, getting a pick there. I think it was his helmet that blocked the Hoban field goal attempt earlier in the year. So he's that kind of guy that can step up and make those plays.
And now trying to cap
Ooh,
it off.
Nice run.
Look at that. And just like that, the Eagles are back in front, 27-24, pending the extra point there. Got to tell you, when Ignatius took that big lead, it sort of looked like, is this going to be it? They were up 17-7. Really impressed with the St. Edward response.
And look at Zalesta, 5'9", 180, kind of hiding behind that offensive line. But he's the kind of running back that St. Ed's has had in the past. Get more than what's blocked. Right there, his alley, it was blocked. He had nowhere to go. He bounced it back to the left side. And this is somebody who's coming off a game where he had nearly 200 yards rushing, Dan, against a stingy Stowe defense. So for him to put up this kind of game against St. Ignatius, it's rare for the Wildcats to give up that kind of rusher.
Yeah, and again, it starts with bringing pressure on Patrick Ryan. Mm-hmm. Makes a bad throw under pressure. Melvin Jackson, look, some guys just know. Some guys in the secondary just know how to go get the football. So that's not really something that can be taught. You just know to go get the football when it's up in the air like that. Melvin Jackson makes the play. And I love that run. That's two runs now we've seen from Zalesta where he was patient. He just waited for something to develop. That was a little cutback. Kind of a nose for the end zone for Zalesta. And look at St. Edward. Kind of giving St. Ignatius back a little bit what they do, taking advantage of mistakes.
Guys, St. Ignatius has only given up 28 points one time this year before tonight. That was in their only loss, an overtime loss to Detroit Catholic Central. Now they've given up 28 points to St. Edwards. Did you see this coming?
Well, we said at the beginning, Aaron, which offense for St. Ed's is going to show up? Is it going to be the one that put up 41 against Stowe last week, or is it going to be the one where the step up in the competition against Hoban, against Elder, against St. Ignatius was something that they simply were not ready for. I mean, you talk about an offense that scored 10 or fewer those three games, and we asked the question, which offense is going to show up? And so far, it's been the offense that we saw more last week against Stowe, and that's what it takes against St. Ignatius. Again, you're not winning a 10-7 game against them. You're just not. You're not winning a 14-10 game against them. You got to show that you can go out there and you can score against the St. Ignatius defense. That's what the team from Detroit did earlier, 28-21. That's what it is going to require for St. Ed's or anybody that faces St. Ignatius.
And this is an Ed's offense, too, that needs a little help, you know, a turnover like that. Against Stowe, they had that turnover, a defensive return for a touchdown, and then on the drive that kind of bled out the clock, it ended in a blocked field goal, but it bled out enough clock that Stowe wasn't able to drive back down. Stowe had, you know, a few penalties on that final drive to kind of keep that offense going. So this is an Ed's offense that maybe on its own isn't able to sustain a lot and score a ton of points, but if you give them opportunities, if you give them turnovers, they can turn that into points.
You know, we talked so much about the Ignatius defense, but now as we head to the fourth quarter and St. Edward has the lead, we'll have to see if the St. Edward defense can maybe step up, make a couple stops to hold on to the win there. Let's head back to Division II now. That game between Anthony Wayne and Olmsted Falls. This one, a back-and-forth affair, and guess who we're about to see?
Uh-oh. You recognize
Spencer Linville. I see him out there.
Some, can't miss him.
Big guy right in the middle of your screen. He's going to run it in from 1 yard out. This one right now, 31-28, Anthony Wayne over Olmsted Falls. It's been a fun one.
Yeah.
We've asked for games with points. We got one here.
And who knew it would be this game? Running the football back and forth against each other. But these are teams that have scored a lot of points by running the football. And Spencer Linville, you said it. You get to that fourth quarter
exactly
against this
right.
guy. You've been trying to tackle him all game. Good luck. You're worn out from that.
Wayne and Olmsted Falls sitting there laughing at all these spread offenses. We're going to throw it back to 1999. What are you guys doing out there? We'll put up points. We'll put up 31 and 28 respectively by running the football down your throat.
And look, we saw Linville run it in there from 1 yard out, but you've got to expect that it was probably a lot of Linville that got him down the field to get to that point, not just doing the short runs that pay off in the end. So Anthony Wayne with a three-point lead in the fourth quarter, 31-28, about 9 minutes to go when Linville punched it into the end zone there. We'll keep our eyes on that one. So that's a three-point game. St. Ed, St. Ignatius is a four-point game. A lot of close games coming down the stretch as we hit the home stretch here of regional final Friday night here all across the Buckeye State. 16 trophies going to head. And out tonight, let's go to Bedford, St. Ignatius, St. Edward, 28-24, under 8 minutes to go.
Third and five here, so maybe a chance to get off the field. Oh, this looks like four down territory. Or you can just
throw.
Do that.
Ooh. What a throw. Wow. I've
seen a few good throws in this game.
I mean, you mentioned it. On third and five, Aaron, you asked, what is Patrick Ryan made of? Can he make the throws in crunch time? That's third and five. That is a passing situation, and he dropped a dime right there.
To Mike Letho for the go-ahead score. Now it's almost getting like the feel of whoever has the ball last is going to win this game.
Once again, that blocked field goal. Don't forget that the blocked field goal in the first
You're right.
half.
It keeps coming up.
Yep.
And, you know, these extra points become more and more important. Of course, St. Ignatius is a very good kicking team.
But that throw on third and five, I mean, that's what you want from your quarterback. That's when you start to feel like we have a quarterback that can lead us to a state title. Third and five. In the past, maybe St. Ignatius tries to run the ball with Bobinski, use that big, powerful offensive line. But there is Coach Kyle trusting his quarterback, a guy who has made plays for them in the passing game throughout the regular season, comes up with a huge throw right there.
He really dropped that one right in there.
Man,
couldn't
ask
for that, but yeah.
Exactly where it had to be.
And he did it. Came up big in the fourth quarter there to give the Wildcats now a three-point lead as they go back and forth. Games going back and forth all across the state. It's a lot of fun. you got games coming down to the wire here with regional championships on the line, chance to play in the state Final Four. If you're playing the weekend after Thanksgiving, that you've had a pretty successful season, no matter what goes on after that.
Yeah, you love the idea of having to go to practice on Thanksgiving morning. That's great. That's what you want when your season starts, to go to practice before you go to Thanksgiving dinner. And that's what these teams are fighting for. And these are the games you love, too. These games when teams are just making plays back and forth. You know, it's not mistake after mistake after mistake. It's I'm going to make a play, now you're going to make a play, and you just go back and forth like this as the game winds down. These are a lot of fun to keep an eye on.
All right, these games winding down. We're going to keep an eye on a whole bunch of them. But first, let's head to break. And as we do, we head back to Hudson. Check out the band and Krista Defini.
Just as athletes need proper sleep for optimum performance, so do fans. To be your best, you need your rest on a properly fitted mattress from Mattress Warehouse. A good night's sleep on the right mattress prepares you for whatever the day throws at you. Visit Mattress Warehouse for a custom sleep assessment, and we'll help you find the right mattress for a great night's sleep and a productive day. Sleep like a champion, play like a champion with the perfect mattress from Mattress Warehouse.
The best thing Tri-C did for me was give me opportunities. The workforce program prepared me for the career I have now. I got a job in the aerospace industry where I work on CNC machines. I have three younger brothers. I want to teach my brothers, you know, hard work actually pays off. Come to Tri-C. It's a great stepping stone to wherever you're trying to get to in life. My name is Chris Grooms, and I got my start at Tri-C.
Saturdays after the big game, Time Warner Cable Sports Channel is Ohio's destination for all things college football. Join Les Levine and Anthony Lima as they break down all the day's action. Listen in live on Coach Urban Meyer's news conference and take your calls on the road ahead for the Scarlet and Gray. More sports and Les Levine postgame. Saturdays after the game on Time Warner Cable Sports Channel.
I'm Stipe Miocic, world heavyweight champion for Nature Stone, and Cleveland's first hometown champ. Fighting can be brutal, so can mold, mildew, or flooding on your basement carpet or tile. Get Nature Stone and never replace your basement flooring again.
Hurry, act now. Get Nature Stone and save up to 50%. That's up to 50% off authentic Nature Stone flooring.
Nature Stone, like me, simply the best.
Act now. Call or visit naturestone.com today.
Football fans, huddle up. Friday nights are about to change forever with Friday Night Huddle. From pregame to postgame and everything in between, Friday Night Huddle is the place for Ohio football action. Combining the resources of cleveland.com, Classic Teleproductions, and Time Warner Cable Sports Channel, Friday Night Huddle gives you unprecedented coverage. You can be part of the action. Get updates as they happen. On cable, online, and on point. Friday Night Huddle. Dominion East Ohio is proud to salute young people in our area who work toward their goals both in the classroom and on the field. We're proud to serve our community and are committed to making a difference. Each year, Dominion partners with schools throughout the region and the entire country to develop new programs aimed at strengthening math and science education in our schools from kindergarten through high school. For more information about our programs, services, and community involvement, www.dom.com. Dominion, it all starts here.
The Ohio Lottery's Partners in Education program has been recognizing students and teachers who shine both in and out of the classroom since 2007. To nominate a deserving teacher or student, go to ohiolottery.com and click on Supporting Education. Students in kindergarten through 12th grade are eligible to be academic all-stars. K through 12 teachers can be honored as the Teacher of the Month. Every school that participates is eligible to be honored as the School of the Year. The Ohio Lottery's Partners in Education, where stars shine.
Tuesday nights are for Ohio college football. And now, Time Warner Cable Sports Channel is teaming up with your favorite site where Ohio State fans gather, 11 Warriors. Join Marissa Cotapelli and the pros who know the team best as they preview the week ahead. 11 Warriors Report, Tuesday nights at 7, only on Time Warner Cable Sports Channel.
All right, welcome back to Friday Night Huddle right here on cleveland.com. Aaron Goldston filling in for Dave Bacon tonight alongside Chris Fedor and Dan Lobby. been a fun night here as we continue to take a trip all across the Buckeye State. We've been checking in a lot from Anthony Wayne and Olmsted Falls. It was a three-point game at last check, while Anthony Wayne opened it up a little bit as they go back to their guy, Nick Schneider. We've seen a tale of two running backs here, Spencer Linville and Nick Schneider. Schneider keeps it, goes through the pile and into the end zone. So now that's a 10-point game, 38-28 in favor of Anthony Wayne. Feel like it's a nice little cushion there in the fourth quarter, but the way this game's going, teams have been scoring pretty easily all night.
A couple running backs now just going back and forth. This is like a one-on-one matchup in basketball almost. This is Dominique Wilkins versus Larry Bird or LeBron James versus Paul Pierce a few years back.
What you're going with?
All sure, right. Why not?
Sure. But I like, from what we've seen from Olmsted Falls, they have stuck to who they are. Now they're down 10. It's obviously not a position that the Bulldogs want to be in, used to being in. But from what we've seen, they've stuck with the ground game because that's who they are, and they feel like they can rip off chunks that way. So even though they're down 10, I would expect them to stick to that running game and keep feeding Linville. It's worked here in the second half.
All right. Well, guys, we have time to hand out our first regional final championship trophy tonight. Kirtland and Cuyahoga Heights has gone final, and we're going to head out there to Solon, check in. Brian Kaiser with us now. Brian, how'd this game finish up?
Final score, Cuyahoga Heights 17, Kirkland 0.
Pretty impressive there, and I understand, do we have head coach Al Martin from Cuyahoga Heights with you there as well?
Got him right next to me.
All right. Coach Martin. Coach Martin, Aaron Goldstein.
Oh, Coach Martin.
Chris Fedor and Dan Lobby here. Congratulations on the win. You beat Kirtland twice in one season after not having beaten them since 2008. What impressed you the most about your team's performance?
Defensively, we really, really played well. We didn't let them establish the line of scrimmage. We tackled really well. Kids got downhill to the ball. So, I mean, defensively, we were great. Offensively, we struggled. They had a really good defensive game plan tonight and played well. We were all out to score on them. But defensively, we were great tonight.
Coach, I think there's a lot of Division VI schools that are wondering, what is your secret? Two shutouts of Kirtland in the same season. What is it about that defense that was so good?
Well, we got a lot of good players over there. I was telling some, we finally have 11 players who are willing to tackle. And if you don't against Kirtland, you're in trouble because they'll make all 11 guys tackle. They'll put 11 guys in the box, and your 11th guy, your worst tackler, has to tackle. So we finally got 11 guys who'll tackle, so that's a big help.
What kind of dimension has Dylan Drummond added for your offense going into where you're going into Columbus?
Well, he gives us balance, obviously, because, you know, we try to run the ball, but you got to cover him, you know, and if you leave him one-on-one, he's pretty good. He goes and gets the ball. He runs really good routes, and our quarterback throws the ball really well. So pass pro was an issue tonight. They did some nice things, and we didn't have enough time, but when we did have time, we were able to make some plays.
Coach, that quarterback, Brett Lothar. We got to see an interview with him after you guys beat Kirtland earlier in the year, and he said he was on the sideline the last time it happened that you guys were able to beat Kirtland. What has he meant, his development to your program and now in winning a regional title?
He's had an incredible season. I mean, he plays both sides. He never comes off the field. He snaps on PATs. He punts the ball. He covers kicks, plays outside linebacker against physical people. And he makes great throws. He got knocked down a lot tonight, and he keeps getting up and making plays. He's a really tough, competitive kid.
Coach, last question, then we'll let you go. You're able to bring the first time since 1998 and just the second time ever, get this Cuyahoga Heights team to the state semifinal. What does that mean for this program?
That's great. I mean, we had some lofty goals when the season started, but I don't know if anyone expected us to have this kind of season. It's a testament to our senior class who's played a lot of football over the years, and they're really on a great run right now. And everybody who's playing is contributing, and it's really a team effort. And it's a great accomplishment to get as far as we've gotten.
Well, we certainly congratulate you and the whole Redskins team on a job well done, beating Kirtland 17-0 here in the regional final, face the Region 23 winner now in the state Final Four. Congratulations, Coach. All right, guys, impressions? 17-0. Wow. They've outscored them now 38-0 in the two meetings this season. Did you see this coming?
I mean, how could you, yeah, right? Because Kirtland doesn't lose until the state finals when they do lose. They either win the state finals or they lose in the state final then. And it's a testament to what Cuyahoga Heights has been able to do. And when they beat Kirtland earlier in the season, it just takes a weight off of you because they haven't been able to do that in so long. And they were able to go into this game without that weight. They've done it. They've beaten that team finally. And now they kind of just got to go up against them on even terms, and they won. Congrats to them.
Yeah, I mean, I think Coach Al Martin mentioned it for offensively for Cuyahoga Heights. We spent so much time tonight talking about the defense, and rightfully so after what they did to Kirtland for a second time this year. But offensively, when you have a guy like Dylan Drummond, the Redskins want to run the ball. When you have him out there, he's going to occupy a guy, maybe even occupy two. Now all of a sudden just brings a different dimension to this offense, like the defense is saying, now we got to worry about him. And then we've got D'Orazio to worry about. We got Lothar to worry about. And there aren't a lot of people that are used to that kind of wide receiver going up against Cuyahoga Heights.
All right, let's change gears again. We got Hudson. Guess what? They're going to need to make another comeback. Head back out there, Warren G. Harding and Hudson. Remember, Hudson was down 14-3, but able to put up a couple quick early scores in the second half. Warren G. Hardy, though, responds. You know Lynn Bowden Wood. Finds Jalen Hicks, 43-yard line there. Bowden impressing so many people. Check out the throw.
Ooh. Nice throw. There was some heat on that throw.
Finds Hooks. And just like that, Warren G. Harding up 21-17, just a few minutes to go there in the fourth quarter. So once again, Hudson trailing in the fourth quarter. Are they able to do it again and make it 6-1 over the last seven games when doing so?
I'm not counting them out.
They're getting the ball lesson, back.
Learned my lesson against Copley. I remember when Copley went up so big, and I'm like, wow, Copley's got this because they're just going to lean on the ground game. They've got Weston Bridges. They're running the ball effectively with Austin Brenner. And then all of a sudden Hudson comes from behind. So I'm not counting them out anymore. They're just so comfortable in this kind of situation. They've got so much experience that they can draw back on, saying we've been in this position before.
Well, now the new uncomfortable is having a lead, I guess. We'll see. We'll see how they respond, because I think when you're going against a guy like Lynn Bowden, If you slip up one time now, right, you might be in some trouble.
Well, and it can't surprise you guys that Bowden, you know, responded and took a lead back there for Harding.
That's why he's one of the guys that's in the running for Mr. Football. You know, in these kinds of situations, you feel like if you're going to be regional champs, it's going to be on his arm, on his legs. And that was him putting up a big, big throw. And he's done that twice now when we've talked about how effective he is running the ball. And it seems like Hudson's been trying to take away that element of his, saying, you know what, I can throw the ball a little bit too.
Made up for that interception too, which is also something you like to see.
All right, so that game coming down to the wire. We'll keep our eyes on that one in Division II. We showed you before, St. Ignatius taking the lead back over St. Edwards. They were up by 3 points, 31-28 at last check as they got close to the fourth quarter of play. Elsewhere, Sycamore had last check had a pretty big 21-7 lead over St. X. Meanwhile, that Pickerington Central Wayne game continues to be 7-7 at last check.
Wow.
Here, there have been four missed field goals in that game. Holding Wayne to 7 points is something that does not happen very often, but the Tigers defense able to do that. And Wayne, though, held, and now returned a punt to the Pickerington Central 1 yard line. So they are knocking on the door there, trying to take a lead in that Region 3 final game. It looks like it would set up a matchup with Sycamore down there in the Division 1 state semifinal.
You mentioned holding them to 7 points. I mean, nobody's really come close. Trotwood Madison held them to 17. Other than that, no one's come close to even holding them to that. And here's Wayne now with an opportunity, though, to take a lead.
That game is still a long way to go. About 11 minutes at last check in that one. So plenty of time though for some teams to put up points. Although 7 points for each side through three quarters, certainly not what we expected there. Guys, fourth quarter. All right, let's before we get thoughts here, let's go to to Lorraine and Olentangy Liberty. Pickerington Central Wayne, excuse me. Pickerington Central Wayne, let's head there and check in on that action.
This looks like the punt
this
here.
This is probably the punt return that we talked about. This came after an interception that set Pickerington Central up pretty good. And there is the punt return.
I think that's something that Wayne has had for the last couple of years, being able to make their postseason run. They've got basketball players playing football. They've got athletes all over the field.
That's Matt Wilcox taking it down to the one-yard line and setting them up in pretty good position. About 9 minutes to go in that game. That one being played down in London, about halfway between the Dayton and Columbus area. As we mentioned, the success that Wayne has had over Central Ohio teams. Looking to continue that streak. They haven't lost to a Central Ohio team in the playoffs since 2013.
And you saw you had to backpedal to field that punt, which means that when you do field it, if you're able to field it, you're going to have a little bit of room to do something. And all you need, those first blocks gave him a lane to run through, and he was able to do the rest.
You can tell if he was frustrated because he got caught at the one-yard line, and he shouldn't have gotten caught at the one-yard line, or if he was a little bit hobbled there and he was slamming his helmet because he didn't know if he was going to be able to go back in the game.
Points are never guaranteed. You didn't get into the end zone. You never know if those are really going to get on the board. So we'll have to see if they're able to punch that in there. Meanwhile, the other division game that we really have, a Division I game that we really haven't talked too much about, Olentangy Liberty and Lorraine. This one a good one. About 5.5 minutes to go in the fourth quarter. Liberty with a 24-20 lead over Lorraine in this one. So another one coming right down to the wire. Here in Division One.
Love it. I mean, you got to fight for these regional titles, no question about it. I mean, we talked about how close the St. Ed's, St. Ignatius game is. We've got the Wayne Pick Central. This is what you want. This is why high school football is so great, and this is why we do a show like this every Friday night, because of these kinds of games.
And for Lorraine, you've got your second playoff appearance of all time. Yep. Their first was in 2014, never won a regional title. Liberty's been there a little bit. This is their third in a row, never won a regional title. So you've got a great game playing out between two teams that are going to make school history tonight.
And they've got a perfect season on the line as they come into tonight, trying to move to 13-0 as they look to knock off Lorraine. They're up by four again with about 5.5 minutes to go in that one as we continue to move on. Again, last check we had Ignatius of 31-28 over St. Ed's, the game that we've been sort of keeping the most tabs on here. Again, reminder, if you're watching us in Northeast Ohio, you can watch that game live on Time Warner Cable Sports Channel. Central Ohio viewers get that Pickerington Central Wayne game that we just checked in on. And Southwest Ohio viewers get that Sycamore St. Xavier game down in the Cincinnati area going on down there. So that is what is going on across Division One. In Division Two, we talked a lot about that Warren G. Harding and Hudson game, where Warren G. Harding taking a late lead there, 21-17 over Hudson. The Explorers trying to come back in that one. Meanwhile, at last check, Anthony Wayne had a 10-point lead over Olmsted Falls, 38-28. That game also in the fourth quarter of play. LaSalle down in Southwest Ohio in Division Two at last check, up big over Miamisburg. It certainly looks like the Lancers are going to advance back to the Final Four for the third straight season. Whew. Guys, where do you go from here?
There's a lot going on tonight, I guess.
Right? You know?
And I'll tell you what, that St. Ignatius St. Ed's game has turned into one of those classic games between the two teams. They've played so many close games in the past. You mentioned that it's not often in the postseason. It's usually in the regular season. But this is what you want. You want these classic games that you're going to remember for a long, long time. And we've got a bunch of those going on right now in Ohio.
Well, we mentioned that the points are never guaranteed when you're at the one-yard line. Let's see if Wayne can punch it in from the one-yard line after they were set up by the great punt return.
Second and goal. And he got that big boy on the outside. I just tossed the ball to him and say, hey, man, go get it. But Wayne being in this position, you got to give them a lot of credit because, Aaron, you mentioned at the beginning of the show, they went from Braxton Miller to Demetri Trice to Messiah DeWeaver. They keep changing quarterbacks, and yet they keep putting themselves in position where they're going to be competing for state titles. I mean, it's incredible to think about.
All right, as they try to punch things in here,
throw the tail
replay there. They had it in high school football. Let's listen in now. It's Todd Bell and Matt DiRaggio on the call.
American Grain offers sales and rentals of scissor lifts, boom lifts, forklifts, rough terrain lifts, and crane services by the day, week, or month. American Crane also provides services on all makes and models of aerial equipment. For more information, contact them at 614-863-3198 or visit AmericanCraneInc.com. And thanks to them, we get great shots like that one looking down right on top of this second end goal play from the one. The game hanging in the balance here with 8:07 to play in the fourth quarter. Those offensive linemen are digging into that field turf. It is Pitts easily in this time for a touchdown. Fred Pitts, touchdown run on the season, number 19.
And he got that ball, and he was not going to be denied again. We talked about the acceleration Davis had on the punt return right there.
All right, Fred Pitts punches it in into the end zone, and Wayne takes a 13-7 lead, pending the extra point. He had a huge game last week against Dublin Kaufman, got into the end zone four times, put up a couple hundred yards on the ground. Obviously, Pickerington Central must be doing a pretty good job holding him in check this week, just the second touchdown that Wayne has scored so far tonight, but couldn't hold him intact completely as he was able to get into the end zone there. It's nice when you get set up at the one-yard line. Though.
Yeah, special teams in a game like this always makes a difference. And you went through the list earlier of the special teams plays that can change a game. And in that case, it was a long punt return, just short. And good on Wayne to be able to kind of capitalize on that and get into the end zone.
As you mentioned, though, Pickerington Central only lost one time this year. It's to Upper Arlington in overtime way back in the middle of the season. So they're certainly a team that is used to winning, and there's still some time left there. So certainly can't count out the Tigers as we come down the stretch in that game. They trail by seven, about 6 minutes or so to go in that game as Pickerington Central gets ready to get the ball back. Meanwhile, where else we go next? Again, last time we checked in St. Ignatius and St. Edward, the Wildcats had that 31-28 lead. And as they continue to play there in the fourth quarter, it's the game that so many people across Northeast Ohio are keeping their eye on. It's a game that we maybe didn't expect to see this many points in. Let's take a live look. And look at that. We are tied 31-31.
Okay.
Things have changed.
And there's a huge development in this game, too. St. Ed's starting quarterback, Kevin Kramer, he got injured in the second half after a 40-yard run to set them up in field goal range. So St. Ed's now on to a backup quarterback in this one. And Kramer, it seemed like, and we didn't see the whole game, but it seemed like he was playing pretty well, and he had learned from the first game against St. Ignatius, and looked like he shook away the jitters.
Now it looks like you're going to force Ignatius to punt from their own 5-yard line.
And one timeout left for St. Ed's.
And Ed's just used a timeout to stop the clock, so they're going to have an opportunity here. Good punt, though.
And a good takes a nice little bounce roll there.
So you got a timeout. You have to get. Where would you feel comfortable kicking from? To 25?
So
I don't
Mason
know, obviously
Waller,
without knowing the leg of the kicker, maybe you know a little better than I do.
So he's already made a 33-yarder in this one. So you're probably right, Dan. Probably want to get around the 25, maybe close to the 20. And again, you're talking about St. Ed's with a backup quarterback here.
Probably wish they could call Notre Dame Cathedral Latin and see if they could borrow their kicker,
for
a play. Who tried a 56-yard field goal earlier and just missed it wide, had the distance.
And St. Ed's did have a field goal blocked in the first half. So when you're talking about distance, you're going to kick it lower and you could get a rush up the middle.
Whew, nice defensive play there by the Wildcats.
And Ed's has to kind of weigh as well as this clock ticks down with a backup quarterback. How aggressive are you going to be?
Yeah.
Because obviously you don't want to turn the ball over. And nice, Ted. Looked like a little bit of a face mask initially, but it looked like you got the inside of the jersey there.
That was Michael Chime with the tackle for Ignatius, bringing down Melvin Jackson.
Ed's is willing to take overtime here in this situation.
Can you blame him?
No.
Hit that?
No.
You don't want to force anything. You don't want to see your season end in a heartbeat just like that. You might as well take the chance and give each team a possession.
And, put your quarterback on a 20-yard field as opposed to having to chuck the ball around on, you know, with that distance.
And again, you couldn't see the entire play, but the quarterback had time. He had time, and it didn't seem like anybody was able to spring open, and that was one of the few times that St. Ignatius hasn't had that dominant pass rush. That seemed more like a coverage sack than anything right there.
We wouldn't want to see that game end the other way than going to overtime, right? Because that's how the Holy War is supposed to go. Wow. We've talked all night long about Hudson. They were trailing to Warren G. Harding in the fourth quarter. Let's head out there and see how the Explorers could respond. Down 21-17, looking to come back for a sixth time in the last seven games after trailing in the fourth quarter. Head out to the field, and Colt Pally, he's going to find Greg Maley. That's a 20-yard touchdown, and the Explorers doing it again. This game now late in the fourth quarter. Hudson in a back-and-forth affair now goes up 24-21 over Warren G. Harding. You knew they were going to respond. Now the question is, does Lynn Bowden respond on the other side?
They just keep responding, too. It's not like they respond once or twice. It doesn't matter. They just keep responding and keep responding. They are absolutely relentless.
And it was Maley who had the touchdown catch against Copley. So when Colt Pallay or whoever it is that's going to be the quarterback for Hudson, one of the three, needs a big play, they look to Maley. And Maley has stepped up and he's made big plays throughout the postseason and throughout the regular season as well. That's the guy that they want to go to. He had one-on-one coverage. He beat his defender. Perfect pass.
We've seen some good throws tonight.
Yeah.
I'll tell you what.
And that one gives Hudson the lead. Man, wouldn't it be interesting to be the coaching staff there having to choose which quarterback you're going to put in as you come down the stretch. Three to choose from. And they seem to be pushing all the right buttons.
Coach Goff said, Colt is the more of the pocket passer. Yeah. And you saw it right there.
And I've got to apologize to Dave Skosin, who sat in that chair last week and was evangelizing for Hudson and saying, don't write off Hudson against Warren Harding. And Dave Bacon and I just kind of laughed at him and said, yeah, they've never faced a Lynn Bowden. Sorry. However this game plays out, I apologize. I wrote off Hudson and obviously should not have.
Look, Pele had more than 15 yards passing this season, 12 touchdowns. So he certainly can get it done in the air. And he gets it done there late in the fourth quarter as Hudson takes the lead. 24-21 over Warren G. Harding. We just showed you St. Edward, St. Ignatius. That one tied at 31, heading into overtime. Each team getting a chance with the ball, as Dan mentioned, starting at the 20-yard line here. Be interesting to see what happens. We haven't heard yet exactly who's going to get the ball first in that overtime, but each team will get a possession. And now it comes down to, hey, who can make the one stop? Who can come up with the one big play? Of course, the Wildcats and Eagles hoping that they're able to do that in advance to the state semifinals. As we reset here, games coming down to the wire. We already told you earlier tonight, Cuyahoga Heights, I should say, advanced to its first state semifinal in 18 years with a 17-0 win over Kirtland. They now shut out the Hornets twice in this season by a combined score of 38-0. So congratulations to Coach Al Martin, who joined us earlier as his teams, the Redskins, head on to the state Final Four. All right, let's head back down to London, where Wayne and Pickerington Central at last check. It was 14-7 in favor of the Warriors. Can the Tigers respond? We head there live as Pickerington Central, that's Morgan Ellison, into the end zone. How do you go three quarters where each team could only score seven? Now all of a sudden it's like they're about to go back and forth. So going to assume that that ties the game here at 14 apiece. Pick Central, Huber Heights, Wayne, all these games in Division I coming right down to the wire. This is fun.
Oh, yeah. You love it. And who knows? Maybe we'll get overtime in that game, too. Why not? Let's take this thing right up to 11 o'clock with these games.
Let's do it. Right now, we're going to head back out to Bedford. St. Ignatius, St. Edward's, overtime period. The Wildcats with the ball first.
And the one thing that overtime kind of does is it takes away the momentum of whatever was happening. So St. Edward probably had the momentum towards the end of that game. You kind of get a chance to hit the reset button now. You get to start at the 20-yard line. Everything that's happened since is over with, and it gives St. Ignatius now a chance to hit the reset button.
from the 14-yard line, go to the ground. That was Babinski down to the 12.
So it's going to be third and short. This is where Ryan has stepped up and made some big throws. He hit the big one on third and 5. Second and 15, he hit a big one earlier. So as much as Babinski has been the go-to guy for St. Ignatius throughout the postseason, would not be surprised at all if Coach Kyle put the ball in the hands of Ryan, who has made some plays tonight.
It's nice to have a guy on second and 8 too, though, that you can hand the ball off to, and he can get you a 3rd and 3, a 3rd and kind of do whatever you want.
Guys, let's just take in exactly what we're looking at right here. Whew. As we sit here, as we watch the overtime game between Ignatius and Edwards, tied at 31. We just showed you Pickering Central tying up the game with Wayne, 14-14. We talked about St. X. They trailed by 14. Guess what? They've come back. That game right now is tied 28-28. So we have 3 of the 4 Division I regional final games going on right now, all of them tied. We have no idea who's going to be playing next Friday night.
That's what you love about Division I.
Yeah.
I mean, you get these games, whether it's in the regional final level, the state semifinal level, or even in the state final. You always have some weekend when you've kind of boiled it down to the best teams and they start going head-to-head against each other. And it's a lot of fun.
All right, here we go. 3rd and 3, big play. Ooh, nice cut back. Picks up the first down.
Great cut. We've seen Zalesta do that a few times tonight for St. Ed's, and that's the vision of Babinski. Nothing was there to the left. St. Ed's, great defense on the play, but just better vision, patience by Babinski, knowing where the alley was going to be on the opposite side.
One of those plays that you almost wonder if it was by design, that cutback, because you had the bunch over on the left side, and everybody pulled over to that left side. You're trying to get St. Edward going one way, you go the other.
Shameless self-promotion, but with all those 3 games tied, all of them available streaming live on twcsportschannel.com. Oh. This one's tied no more. Babinski into the end zone. And now the pressure will go on to that St. Edward's offense. First, the pressure on the Wildcats kicker to extend this lead to 7.
Yeah, you don't want to only be up 6 after the first overtime and give St. Edward a chance to score and win on an extra point. You want to get this thing at 7 and take a little bit of pressure off of your defense at least.
And the pressure shifts to not just St. Ed's offense here, but St. Ed's offense being run by a backup quarterback. You know, you talk about all the tough spots that you could put any backup quarterback in. You're talking about playing St. Ignatius, your rival, in the postseason, coming in the fourth quarter, now overtime, and having to score a touchdown to keep your season alive, a season that was once in the hands of Kevin Kramer.
How much then do you feel like the focus then shifts to Zalesta, maybe trying to take some pressure off that backup quarterback?
Well, sure, but that's where St. Ignatius is going to focus.
certainly the focus of Ignatius is going to be on
Chuck Kyle's been around for a long time. He's a really smart guy, and he's going to say, okay, if I'm going to lose, make it be the backup quarterback beating me, because I don't think he can. But don't let it be Zalesta. Don't let it be Hoover on an end around, something like that.
That backup quarterback's Melvin Jackson, number 1 there, in the shotgun as they start the drive. Oh,
goodness,
and he's going to the air first.
He's got him.
He could have. It looked like that ball maybe hung up a little too long.
And you know, sometimes that's maybe just not having that connection with your wide receiver. You haven't been out there playing with these guys. I like the aggression, though.
You certainly feel like if that was Kramer, we saw him drop a ball at the end of the first half.
Timing's just a little off sometimes.
That was Demarius Freeman there trying to haul it in. You could see him just sort of waiting for it to come down.
That was the perfect play call, too. Everybody at Bedford, including St. Ignatius, their sideline, was expecting a run to Zalesta. And that's a perfect play call right there. But we talked about earlier, you know, when you get those opportunities, those shot plays, you have to execute them. And that was the perfect play call. It just, the execution was a little bit off there.
All right, so now you're Coach Lombardo. You've tried it once. At this point, now you're facing 2nd and 10. Do you have to go back to the ground?
Well, it's interesting. They're coming out in a 4-wide formation. And they're putting their quarterback in a shotgun. So they're coming out in a passing formation. That doesn't mean they can't run out of it, obviously, but they're certainly not showing run when they line up. Looks like they're going to stay in the same formation.
We've seen
here
it
for this
too.
Point.
Melvin Jackson, the guy who can do things with his feet, so wouldn't be surprised to see if they maybe keep the ball in his hands. That's Celesta. Just taken down. Loss of three on the play.
And this is where you want to make sure your quarterback understands. Yeah, it's going to be third down and 12 or third down and 13, but you don't need those 12 or 13 yards on this play. This is, you've got two downs to pick up those yards, so you can set up a fourth and five. You don't have to get it all back in one play.
Third and 12. What are you going to dial up here?
He should show the
blitz. And Jackson keeps it, and Wildcats not fooled. Look for a second that maybe they would be. A lot of them went with Celesta there on the play action.
Now it comes down to fourth and long, a situation that you don't want to be in against St. Ignatius.
And it allows Ignatius to kind of sit back and play almost like you'd play a third and long. Obviously, you can just make sure. You just have to tackle. That's all you need to do. Don't let anybody get behind you and tackle.
Let me correct myself. A couple number ones on the St. Edward roster. The QB actually Garrett Zorro, not Melvin Jackson. Here you go, your ball game.
Oh,
are they going to throw a flag? No.
Got to come down with that.
That was Cordell Hoover in the end zone. And St. Ignatius, 38-31 winner in a classic.
Wow.
A game that went back and forth, had a little bit of everything. You guys mentioned that blocked field goal early on. Yeah. That certainly changing. That came back into play as this game went to overtime. But Ignatius able to get the touchdown on the first possession of overtime. And then hold on with their defense. A couple great chances for the Eagles there.
This wasn't a bad throw. I mean, this kid made a couple of good throws.
And a lot of contact there before.
Yeah.
Before the ball got there, that's Alexander Ringfield on the coverage for the Wildcats. Flag staying in the pocket, though.
And you could see Hoover look. He was looking at the official. He sensed a little bit of contact. But look, if you're St. Ed's and you've got a fourth down play with your season on the line, you tried getting the ball to the guy that you needed to get the ball to. Cordell Hoover is one of your playmakers. It's him and Celesta. It's been those two all season long. So you had an opportunity, Hoover in the end zone. He got his hands on it. There was contact. It was a tough catch. But, I mean, with a backup quarterback, I don't know that you could have asked for anything other than that.
And you can't look to the officials to bail you out. Obviously, like we said, we saw contact on that. You can make the case for the flag, but it wasn't egregious. Even on the replay, it wasn't egregious. And the officials decided they didn't want to throw the flag on that. You just can't rely on that. Great job by Eds to fight back in that game, get it into overtime. Ignatius, we've kind of said all along, maybe is the best team in Region 1, and they end up as Region 1 champs.
And with the win, Ignatius now advancing to their 15th Final Four, but their first since 2011, where that year they also went on to win the state title. They've been to the state Final Four 14 years coming into tonight. They've won 11 titles.
Yeah.
So they certainly have pretty good success when they get this far in a season.
Yeah, it's for them. It's getting out of Northeast Ohio. It's getting past Solon. It's getting past St. Ed's. It's getting past those kinds of teams. They have shown, and I think part of it is because they go out in the regular season and they play against the Cincinnati teams, whether it be Elder, whether it be Moeller, whether it be St. Xavier. So when they see those teams in the postseason, there's enough of a familiarity. There's enough of a comfort zone playing against those teams. And for St. Ignatius, the challenge, the biggest challenge, has been getting out of Northeast Ohio. And St. Ed's was that hurdle that they needed to clear, and kudos to them tonight. They were able to do that, and Bobinski's run was very impressive at the end of the game.
All right, so St. Ignatius moving on to the state Final Four. Meanwhile, still two more games tied as we go down the stretch here in Division I. We're going to take you live. St. X Sycamore, 30 seconds to go, tied at 28. This is the Bombers as the flag comes down on the play, making things happen, but we'll have to see if this one's going to come back. Yeah. Certainly looked like a hold where that flag was thrown.
Big shot there, too. Clifford, a kid heading to Penn State, play quarterback. Take a shot on this play.
Yeah, you would hope that the quarterback would just get down right there. And
He's a big dude, though, and you can tell because he's the one that took the shot, but he's the one that's still kind of standing afterwards. He's didn't even really go down, just stayed on his knees. Everybody else is laying on the ground around him.
That's Sean Clifford, 6'3", 210 pounds, as Dan mentioned, headed off to Penn State next year, but coming back on the penalty. So it looks like bringing up a second 21, Steve Speck. Yeah, not so happy about that one.
And you're faced with that decision. You be careful and play for overtime. You probably don't if you have a quarterback like Clifford. And they clearly are not.
And thrown into double coverage, probably lucky that that one didn't get picked off. But at that point, you know what? If that one gets picked off, as long as you stop a run back, there's probably not much harm that's gonna happen in that. Do you take here 7 seconds left? Do you take one more shot?
Yeah, for sure. Crazy things happen in high school football. Absolutely. See if you can get behind the defense, break a tackle, something along those lines. Absolutely, you take a shot, especially with a quarterback like that. That's why you have a kid like that. But you can see the head coach, he was telling his quarterback, go, go, go. The clock's going to run as soon as you're ready. And it looked like St. Xavier lost about 6-7 seconds on that play because they couldn't get lined up in time.
All right, here we go. Final play of regulation. Clifford's going to keep it. Unless he get out of bounds here, maybe with a second or two left.
Trying to set up a manageable throw. That was risky, though.
It was.
He used 6 of those 7 seconds.
Looked like he may have had his eye on the clock, able to step out there with a second to go. You hear Steve Speck, maybe you wish he just said.
Yeah.
Hair turned a little more gray on that run.
You never know when that clock operator's going to hit the stop button. But he got it in time. St. X still has a timeout left if they decide they want to talk about this one and what they want to do.
Previous throw went what, about 50? 20 to the 20? Right about that? So he might have enough. Man, some high school kids can't get it there. He might have enough. Let's see if he does.
See how far he can throw it. Got plenty of time, that's for sure. Whew! And then he just, nothing open. Unless.
Flip it. Big problem, fella was waiting.
The problem with flipping it in this situation is, you know, you can't let that ball go back the other way and end the game in a heartbreaker. So, you know, guess what? We got a second Division I game going to overtime.
That's interesting that he never threw it. He's almost waiting for somebody to come open.
Yeah, you don't need anybody
open. No, you just throw it up there.
Throw the Hail Mary there, I think. But maybe they thought they had something and somebody would come open. I don't know. But that was a bizarre series.
I wanted to see his arm.
I did,
come
too.
Come on, now I want to see. He had the time to get it there.
So for the second straight week now, St. X heading into overtime. Last week, they came from behind, able to tie things up in regulation and then beat Coleraine. This week, they are now came from 14 points back against Sycamore and heading into overtime with the Ave. So we'll certainly keep our tabs on that. Meanwhile, Pick Central and Wayne, that game was tied with 14 with about a minute to play. Looks like though Pick Central trying to drive down the field. They had the ball on the Wayne 7-yard line right now as they try to take a late lead in the final minute there and knock off Wayne in a game that has been, points have been hard to come by today.
Yeah, all over the place points have been hard to come by, except in second halves we've seen it kind of open up, except for in this game. This has been the outlier so far. Let's see what happens. I mean, when you're going against Wayne, you know how good they are. Pickerington Central has been up for the challenge.
All right, well, keep an eye definitely on both these Division I games. But in the meantime, let's head back to Division IV. Steubenville and Shelby, the Whippet, and the Big Red. Jeff Szabo there. Jeff, what do you got for us for an update?
Well, final score here from Paul Brown Maslin Tiger Stadium. It is Steubenville 29, Shelby 15. Steubenville was able to get a late score by Jacob Bernard late in the game. And defensively in the second half, they really picked it up. They really started putting more linebackers in the box. And as a result, they were able to stop Shelby at key moments of that second half.
Jeff, you mentioned they put more people in the box. Is that how they were kind of able to contain Brennan Armstrong?
At certain times, yes. There were moments in which Armstrong was contained just by putting more linebackers in the box. And then there were certain times when Shelby would hand the ball up the middle to Devin Brown just to try and get some momentum going. And almost as soon as Brown had the ball, he was sacked behind the line or tackled behind the line of scrimmage. And there were also some other instances in which Shelby really had their opportunities in the red zone, but either couldn't capitalize or they just couldn't get in the end zone. And that really proved to be a pretty big difference in the game.
What were your impressions of Steubenville? Assess their chances moving forward.
Really just a team that didn't quit, a team that can really adjust. There were times in which they could have let their guard up a little bit, and they could have let Shelby creep back into this one, but they stuck with their game plan. They played very well defensively. They really started to key in, and they took advantage of turnovers that occurred in the second half. I really think that the Steubenville team, you know, when all the pieces start falling into place, they can move the ball down the field, not just with the running game, but they also do have a couple of wide receivers that get open pretty well. And once that passing game gets going, they really have a pretty fluid offense that can take advantage of a lot of the opportunities.
All right, Jeff, we certainly appreciate it. Steubenville, the big win here. Moving on now to their 17th Final Four in program history. Of course, last year they were able to move all the way to the state title game. See if they can do that next Friday night. Thanks, Jeff. All right, back to Division I. Pickerington Central and Wayne. We mentioned it was 14-14 coming down to the wire. Let's take a look in and see how we'll wait a second here as we see how that one finishes up. Coming down to the wire, Pickerington Central, we mentioned it, driving down the field, trying to see if they could end the Warriors' season and head on to the state Final Four. We'll get to that game in just a minute. Impressions, though, first of Steubenville.
Well, on the other side, good news for Shelby is Brennan Armstrong is only a junior, so they'll have him back, dual-threat quarterback, getting looks from teams like North Carolina, even Ohio State kind of on the radar, three-star kids. So they certainly, when you have a guy like that on your roster, certainly hopes heading into the next year. But Steubenville just kind of doing what they do. You know, they were able to bottle up that rushing attack and win a tough game against the Whippets.
Against the Whippets. Well, speaking of that, we'll stick with that game for now. Jacob Bernard joining us on the phone after the Big Red big win over Shelby. Congratulations, Jacob, on the win. What are your impressions after the 29-15 victory for your team tonight?
All right, Jacob, your team didn't quit in the second half. Defensively, they really made some key stops. What really attributed to your team's success?
I think just basically staying on offense as long as we could. And just keep moving the ball, moving the chain.
And then you, it really looked like your offensive line really stood up at certain times and really gave you a pretty big push.
Yeah, they definitely did. They made some nice holes for me in that second half.
And then also talking about also the wide receivers, they got open at times and they made some pretty good plays.
Oh yeah, I gotta give them good credit for that. Real good.
And then take us through that last touchdown that you had towards the end. It obviously turned out to be the difference maker. What really helped you get in the end zone right there?
Actually pushing the back on the end and staying off my knee.
All right, and you guys excited for the next round?
Oh yeah, definitely.
All right, what do you think you should expect from here on out?
Good talent and just work hard, I guess, and we'll be good.
All right, thank you.
All right, Jacob Bernard there after Steubenville's 29-15 win over Shelby. We mentioned the two Division I games that were still going on. We saw St. X and Sycamore head into overtime there down in Southwest Ohio in Mason. Meanwhile, in London, Pickerington Central and Wayne tied 14-14 apiece as they came down in the final minute, so we'll check in on that one coming up in just a little bit. Meanwhile, in the other Division I regional final, in Region 2, it was Olentangy Liberty coming away with a four-point win over Lorain, ending the Titans season.
Yeah, heck of a season for Lorain. I mentioned they hadn't won 10 games in a season since 1930. Think about everything that's been invented since then. So for them to start the year with two straight losses, Midview, Elyria, then rip off 10 in a row and beat Olentangy, beat Dublin, Jerome, show that, you know, they've got the pieces to compete on this kind of level when you get to the playoffs, but fall short. When you lose to a team that's undefeated at this point, like, I don't think you hold your head down or you feel like you squandered an opportunity. It's one of those situations where even though Lorraine lost, huge step forward for the program and tons of things to be proud of.
All right, we want to welcome the viewers who are joining us now who are watching the St. Ignatius-St. Edward game on Time Warner Cable Sports Channel. Of course, St. Ignatius with the 38-31 win over St. Edward in overtime. Aaron Goldstein, Chris Feeder, Dan Lobby taking it all the way up to 11 o'clock in High School Blitz right here on Time Warner Cable Sports Channel. We mentioned the Region 3 game, Pickerington Central and Wayne. Tied 14-14 in the final minute. Let's go now. They're live. It's Todd Bell, Matt D'Orazio on the call, guys.
You don't need to get, fight for it and give up the ball. Just get down, and you're in perfect position to win this football game.
Timeout, Pick Central. And that'll give us an opportunity to see how Pick Central answered that touchdown. And, Matt, we were thrown off guard because the second time tonight, they were in the same fake punt. Was a huge gainer down the right sideline to Tavon Myers after they had a touchdown taken off the board. They recovered from that and a holding penalty. And then Ellison scores on the one-yard leap to tie it. And now a huge run by Darius Coker has set them up first down and goal from the seven-yard line. A lot of things to run through here. First off, for Wayne, they got to keep him out of the end zone.
Yep.
Obvious. Force him into a field goal try where tonight Brandon Mulver has missed twice. They were lengthy tries, but that's all you can hope for right now if you're Wayne.
Yeah, and if you're Pickering Central, you've got to try to find a way. Obviously, like you said, you want to score a touchdown here. You don't want to leave it up to the kicking game. It's just not been working out well all night long. So you want to cross the goal line. You want to get those 6 points and secure the victory that way. Now it's just trying to find a way of what play is going to do that. What are we going to do that's been working and we're going to capitalize on it?
Ellison is back out there. First and goal. Inside the five for the senior running back on his way to Ohio University next year. Let's check in again with Marty Bannister as we've got a timeout called by Pickerington Central, their second use. Marty?
Well, Darius Coker, guys, earlier in the week, Jay Sherrick called him their leader. And when you think back to the season the young man has had, the long run he snapped off a couple of moments ago to put them in this goal situation. Remember, he broke his leg injury earlier this year that took him out of five games after the fourth game of the season. He comes back in the 10th game, and all he does in that game is go 7-for-8 and throw a couple of touchdown passes, which we were talking to Jay Sherrick. He didn't sound surprised at that at all. And again, we touched on at the top of the telecast tonight about the offensive line. They take pride in not letting people get to Darius Coker, and you see why when he snapped off that long run. But he's a guy, everybody follows him over there in Pickerington Central. They know what the kid's all about. And tonight he's made a huge play. He's given him a chance to win this game with under a minute left.
He had 163 yards rushing last week in their win, and this big run here tonight, Matt, has set him up to try and win this one.
I think for him, it's finding a way to win. That's the kind of leader he is. You know, he may do it with his arm at times. He can do it with his legs. He protects the football. He makes good decisions. And the key is he's a winner. And you know, when you're a winner, you find a way to win. It may not look pretty all the time, but at the end of the day, you get the W.
From the five, it'll be second down, and they go with Jermichael Graham in the backfield. Coker on the keep, dropped behind the line of scrimmage by Crane. Wayne thinking the ball had popped out, it had not, and third down coming up.
Tried a little misdirection here. We've got the underneath motion, trying to some deception. Try to give the ball back to Coker because he was the guy that had the big run. He's the big frame.
thing about it is this Wayne defense is too tough. Not fooled at all, and tons of pressure.
And Wayne will try and preserve some time here, and they'll call their last timeout, which will give us an opportunity to tell you that in Region 1, it is a final Cleveland St. Ignatius over St. Ed's 38-31 in overtime.
Holy cow.
No holy war.
There you go. Just some solid football anywhere you go. And, you know, back to Coach Minton's, you know, comments, that's what Friday night's all about, right? It's about Friday night football and playing it. And so far tonight, we've seen some and heard about some crazy games.
Well, this one has had a little bit of everything. How is it going to unfold? I have no idea. If you're Pickerington Central here, do you dare go to the air? Right now you're on the near side hash mark. Do you run something towards the right to try and get it between the hashes to set it up for your kicker? Or do you trust Darius Coker and maybe the tight end Trenton Gillison, who's had a couple of key catches tonight?
I'm not sure, but all I do know is that Jay Sher has run two successful fake punts, so he's not afraid to roll the dice. He did it was in his own territory at crucial points in the game. Don't be surprised if he does something similar right here.
There's Darius Coker. This Wayne defense has given up as many points tonight as they did in the first two games of the playoffs. It's still only 14. Coker will work out of the gun and an empty backfield. On third down, he will run on the quarterback draw inside the five. Still on his feet, and to the two. And Wayne cannot stop it. And if you're Pickerington Central, you're going to let this go down and call timeout, and it's going to be on the legs of Brandon Bulmer.
So this play was a little bit of both. Try to get to the middle of the field. If we can score, great. We win the football game. If we don't, it's basically like an extra point,
yep.
and our kicker is lined up and ready to go, and to give him confidence in exactly what he's been successful on all year is converting on extra points.
We'll come down to senior Brandon Bulmer. And again, including tonight, 45 of 49 on point afters. And again, this is virtually an extra point with where the ball is sitting as Pickerington Central will use its final timeout. And the run for the Wayne Warriors, 10-2 in their last 12 playoff games. Those two losses in the state championship game to Lakewood St. Ed's. And the Tigers of Pickerington Central, twice state runners-up in 2006 and in 2011, are a field goal away from playing either St. Xavier or Sycamore next week in a state semifinal. That game's in overtime.
All right, well, he didn't get to see it, but Pickerington Central goes on and kicks the field goal. He did make it, and Pickerington Central pulls the, what you got to call, a little bit of an upset there, coming down a last-second field goal, win 17-14. See if we have a chance to see this finish up here. Took the suspense away, I guess, but when you're kicking it from there, you'd hope that there's not too much suspense.
You know what, I don't if you're a 17, 18-year-old kid in this spot, I don't think there is such a thing as an easy kick.
Out of the Dalton Stefanidis hold.
What a start. Brandon Vollmer sending the Tigers to the state finals four. And there you have it, 17-14, the final. I got to tell you, whoever picked the games this week on Time Warner Cable Sports Channel, kudos to you. Three games all coming down right to the wire. St. Ignatius, St. Edward, pick Central Wayne with the Tigers winning in the final second as time expired on that Vollmer field goal. And Sycamore, St. Xavier headed to overtime, tied at 28. The Bombers coming from 14 points down again, a second straight week where they've come from behind and forced overtime. Could they take advantage in the overtime like they did last week? Last week, that was the case where Coleraine got the ball first, could not score. This week, the Bombers getting the ball first as we check in down in Southwest Ohio. Those two teams headed into overtime tied at 28. Sean Clifford can get the first opportunity in that game to give the Bombers the lead, something that they have not had in quite a long time.
I think you're all right with that. I think you're all right with putting the ball in Clifford's hands and letting him kind of dictate what happens in these overtime periods.
It'll be interesting to see. We're going to take a look down in Southwest Ohio. That game being played at Mason High School there tonight as the 5-7 seed. Look at it. We already saw 1-7 seed. Did NDCF down? All my scores getting mixed up. Did NDCL move on to win? They were in a good spot, trailing 8-6 last we checked there. Sycamore trying to be a 7 seed as well, advancing on to trying to advance on to the state Final Four again. That game tied 28-28 as they head into overtime. The final region or the final Division One game that's still going on here. Southwest Ohio viewers can watch that game on Time Warner Cable Sports Channel. Everyone can see it on TWCSportsChannel.com. It's streaming live right there as well. Well, you saw the ending there to the Pick Central Wayne game. Impressions on that?
Well, Pick Central's defense, are you kidding me? They held Heber Heights Wayne right? to 14 points, and one of those touchdowns was set up by a big, long punt return, getting it down to the one. So holding Heber Heights Wayne to 14, that says a lot about Pick Central's defense.
All right, now let's go to Mason. Sanex and Sycamore tied at 28 as they head into overtime. The Bombers getting the ball first in the extra session. And that is Clifford, and he connects into the end zone to give St. X that lead that they've long been looking for. Able to connect with Andrew Wittrock for the touchdown. Nice looking pass from Clifford.
Yeah, you know, good little timing shoulder throw right there.
Right to the pylon, and that game now has just gone final. Sycamore converted on a 3rd-and-14 to set up a 1st-and-goal at the 10, but the Bombers' defense came up big, able to stop them after that. And Sycamore's dream season, the first time they ever made it this far, comes to an end here. 35-28, the final, as St. X advances to the state final for a team that was 5-5 in the regular season, now 3-0 in the playoffs.
How about these numbers from Sean Clifford? This is from St. Xavier's live stats site. Mm-hmm. 19 of 27 for 229, couple of scores. Pretty good, right?
Yeah.
21 rushes, 171 yards, two more scores.
Yeah.
When you have a guy like that, a guy that's going to Penn State, he's listed as a pro-style quarterback, but obviously he's shown his ability to run the football. When you have a guy like that, you've got a chance to win any game you play in, even a game when you're trailing like the Bombers were.
Want to welcome the audience that was watching the Pickerington Central Wayne game. You guys saw the Tigers win 17-14 over the Warriors to advance to the state Final Four. Thanks for joining us here on Friday Night Huddle. Aaron Goldstein, Chris Feeder, Dan Lobby taking you all the way up to 11 o'clock. And then you make sure you stay with us because we got High School Blitz from 11 to 11:30. Neil Sika, Matt Finkus will have highlights from games all across the state. 12 of the 16 games all across the state you'll get to see highlights from. And then at 11:30 on Time Warner Cable Sports Channel, another game in your area that you will get to see. So all these games coming down to the wire, we now know the state semifinals in Division One. It'll be St. X against Pickerington Central on one side, and it will be St. Ignatius against Olentangy Liberty on the other side. Only one top seed advances to the state Final Four, and who would have thought it'd be Olentangy Liberty?
Although, again, sometimes you have to look at the seedings a little side-eyed because St. Ignatius we talked about.
Yeah.
We've kind of talked about throughout the season we've thought was the best team in
right.
their region. St. Xavier, Aaron, you mentioned a lot of people think they played the toughest schedule in the country. So obviously, yeah, they got a 5 next to their name. But, again, take that with a grain of salt because right. there's a chance that they were maybe the best team. Obviously, it played out that they were the best team in the region, but there's a chance that maybe they were the best team in that region coming in to begin with.
That's why when you look at teams, you have to ask how and why, and you have to dig into their schedule because there are a lot of teams in Division One, whether it's Region 1, 2, 3, 4, they stack their schedule so much so that they're battle tested. I remember having a conversation with head coach Steve Trevisano from Mentor a few years ago, saying, we play the kind of schedule that we do so that we can use the regular season to prepare for the postseason. And it doesn't matter to these teams if they go in as a 4 seed or a 5 seed or a 7 seed, because that's not always representative of the kind of team that they put out there. So 5 St. Xavier is not your typical 5 seed. We're talking about one of the best teams, a battle-tested team. They've played St. John Bosco from California, Coleraine, Mentor, St. Ignatius once already. They beat Coleraine so far in the postseason. So it's always important to ask yourself how and why and dig into how they got to the record that they have.
As you guys look ahead now to next week in the state semifinals, certainly St. Xavier and St. Ignatius, the two power names on this bracket. What do you expect to see there?
Well, they're the two power names, and I think they won two power regions.
That
gives them an edge. If I had to pick, I would say it would be Ignatius versus Xavier in the final, but sometimes you go through that difficult region and then you've got to play a team like Liberty that's gone through maybe not as good a region, but that's still a good football team. You got to play Pickerington Central. Look, they had to beat a good Wayne team to get where they are. Yeah. So nothing is given in this round of the playoffs, no matter who you are, no matter what region you came out of. I would think we'd end up with Ignatius Xavier, but nothing surprises you in Division I.
All right, don't tell that to Coach Steve Hale of Olentangy Liberty Patriots. It's Patriots, a 24-20 win over Lorain tonight. Let's head out to Mansfield and check in with Coach Hale.
I thought we struggled a little bit early. You know, it's probably a little bit of nerves. You know, we first time in a region championship. I thought our kids fought through a lot of adversity really well. That's a really good football team. Really good football team. Coach has done an amazing job there. Those guys play hard. Nate come after. He's got some really good players. I thought our kids fought through it all the way right up to the very end. And, we got some things we got to clean up this week if we want to get better next week.
Hey, congratulations.
We'll just put the film in.
All right, there you go. Patriots moving on.
Dan's right. You don't want to take anything away from anybody that's advanced to this point. And as he said, paying homage to LeBron, nothing is given, everything is earned. And this is no disrespect to the other teams that are there, but I thought there was one team that could have prevented St. Ignatius from winning a state championship, and they got over that team tonight, and it was St. Ed's. So to me, St. Ignatius is the best team going into the semifinals. Does it always play out that way? No, it's football. Crazy things happen. Crazy bounces happen. But to me, that was the hurdle that St. Ignatius needed to clear in order to win the state title.
And one thing to take away from that game, we heard from Steve Hale. One of the things from doing this show that I'll kind of remember is Dave McFarland, the night they clinched that playoff berth.
Yeah.
And just how proud he was of that football team and the program he's built there. We've kind of talked about how he's gone after players to get guys to come out and play football. And it's kind of what high school football is all about, these programs that kind of get built up and built up, and he's done a great job with that program. And even though they didn't get that first regional title, they've got something going there in Lorain.
Well, speaking of Dave McFarland, great, always gracious in the loss, let's head back to Mansfield and check in with the Lorain head coach.
Well, give them a lot of credit. They're a great football team, and I thought they wore us down. We're pretty physical. Carlos gave us about every ounce he had, and our defensive MVP, Quentin Pardone, was out with a knee injury. They went back in, and he gave us all he had. Most teams were pretty beat up, but just kind of a numbers game, I guess. In the second half, we didn't have a little bit of extra oomph on defense. They made some great plays. That's what great championship football is all about, right there. We had a chance to win it at the end of the game, and I couldn't be any prouder.
Almost did you guys miss Sly out there too?
Oh, there's no doubt. Our left tackle was hurting his ankle in that game, and then Sly had the right tackle wasn't there, and then we had a backup tackle, and that certainly hurt our running game a lot. But again, there's no excuses. They played a great game, and I'll tell you what, you watch our young men out there tonight, they played with great pride, they represented well, and it's hard to lose a game, but I couldn't be any prouder.
All right, there you go. Coach Dave McFarland after his team's 24-20 loss at the hands of Olentangy Liberty. All right, we've talked a lot about Division I, Division II. Those games have gone final, so we know the four teams that are going to play next week in the state semifinal. What we don't know at this point is who's going to play each other. It's the one division that was left open as to which regions were going to match up with each other. However, we have talked all night about the Hudson-Harding game. We've talked about the comeback from the Explorers, and they're able to pull it off. 24-21, the final in that one. Meanwhile, elsewhere, Massillon Perry, they pull off a 17-6 win over New Albany. LaSalle, a huge win, 45-14 over Miamisburg. And in the other one, Anthony Wayne, a 38-31 win over Olmsted Falls. So the four teams are all set in Division II. We're just waiting to find out the matchups.
Yeah, it'll be interesting to kind of see how they end up pairing that up. How about Hudson? Back to the state semifinals. You count them out. You just can't do that. They're too good of a program, and especially now that they've moved down to Division II recently, when they made Division I a little bit smaller, Hudson has been able to take advantage of that. They're playing against schools that are a little more their size. They were always one of the smaller Division I's, and they're just proving that as good as they were in Division I, they're even better in Division II.
And the thing that stands out to me when it comes to Hudson, Aaron, and we heard from the Olentangy Liberty head coach saying that our guys had a lot of nerves going into tonight. And you might be thinking, well, they're 12-0. They went undefeated. How is that possible? Those guys haven't been there before. Hudson has been there. They understand what it takes to win this time of year. And their players, whether they were playing in the game physically or not, they were in that kind of environment. And any time they play against those kinds of teams that haven't been there before, they're going to have the advantage. And I think you see something like that show up when you're in the postseason.
Explorers heading to the state Final Four for the third straight year. Pretty impressive. We mentioned the Anthony Wayne win over Olmsted Falls. The Generals able to hold off the Bulldogs. Tim Bielik has been there all night. Tim, what did you see from Anthony Wayne that impressed you?
Well, it was, as advertised, a matchup of two running football teams. Doing it a little bit of different ways, but 38-31 final score. Anthony Wayne pretty much led wire to wire after the first quarter when they took a 14-7 lead. Generals going for 509 yards on the ground. They only attempted one pass. It was incomplete, but Evan Brown goes for 287 yards, two touchdowns. Nick Schneider, the quarterback, pretty much just as effective, 226 yards rushing, three touchdowns, including the one with about 337 left that proved to be the game winner. Bulldogs just not able to get much going on defense. They only stopped one third down attempt from Anthony Wayne in the game, and I thought that was the difference. They were behind by 14 at halftime, cut it to three, but just they were not able to get Anthony Wayne off the field when it mattered, and that's the reason why the Generals are into the Final Four.
You mentioned all the rushing yards and the one pass attempt. So what is it that makes Anthony Wayne's offense so effective when everybody knows they're going to run the ball?
Well, Coach Tom DeLuca mentioned after the game, Anthony Wayne's offensive line was just fantastic. They were able to create holes for both Brown and Schneider to run through. Both of them very patient runners. Brown was very patient, waited for the running lane to open, and when he saw it, he just took off with it. They didn't really have many big runs. They churned out about 7-8 yards at a time. And most of the time in this game, Olmsted Falls was really off balance. They couldn't get a hand on Brown or Schneider until about 5 yards down the field. And when the first contact you make with the back is usually 5-6 yards down the field, if you're an offense, that's a pretty good sign.
All right, Anthony Wayne moving on to the state semifinals. We said they await to find out who their opponent will be next weekend. I'm expecting the OHSAA to come out with the announcing those matchups coming up really probably anytime soon. Thanks, Tim. We appreciate all the work down there at that game tonight. All right, guys, final few minutes of the show. Biggest impressions that you take out of this regional final Friday night?
Hudson. I've got to say it, Hudson. And I would imagine they're going to get Perry next week. Those schools pretty close together. It's a tough spot for LaSalle because they're not close to any of those schools. But I would imagine they would end up with Anthony Wayne, who's up near Toledo. But Hudson, man, just keep coming back against a very good Warren Harding team. What can you say about them? There's really not much more to say about that school other than, man, they are resilient.
I'll say St. Xavier. You talk about beating Coleraine last week in overtime and asking yourself, what did that take out of you? Are you going to be mentally and physically ready for the game against Sycamore? They got down. They came from behind. They showed why. They played the toughest schedule in the area. They've probably had the toughest road to this point, and yet through it all, they're here, and they knocked off a team 2 weeks ago that a lot of people felt like could win a state championship in Coleraine. So the Bombers, despite that record, despite the seed, for them to win again tonight against Sycamore after beating Coleraine last week, hats off to them. Heck of a team. They're going to be tough next week.
They are heading to their seventh Final Four in program history. The first time, hard to believe, the first time since 2011 that St. Xavier has won a regional title and advanced to the state Final Four. They haven't won a championship. They've won two of them total, haven't won since 2007. Let's take a last look at the brackets here in Division Four. Here's how it all lines up. That is Perry and Steubenville on one side of the bracket, and then the defending champs, Bishop Hartley and Archbishop Alter. Would you guys be surprised at all if we saw a rematch of last year's state final between Hartley and Steubenville?
Well, Perry's going to have something to say about it, though. Let me tell you, Perry's been good all season long. It was a grinded-out win for Perry, a different kind of win than what they're used to, and I think that shows a lot, especially going into a game against Steubenville, where you're probably going to have to win that kind of game.
And Colston Brewster is a nice quarterback for them, too. Smart kid as well. Some of the schools looking at him, they're looking at Ivy League opportunities maybe for him after his senior season next year. So smart, talented quarterback for Perry, and that can take you a long ways.
We saw a couple seven seeds come awfully close in trying to pull the upsets and get to the Final Four, but Sycamore fell just short. Notre Dame Cathedral Latin falls just short. And that, there you see at the top seed, Perry moving on to face Steubenville coming up on next Friday night, and one win away from advancing to the state championship games at Ohio Stadium. Those are taking place December 1st, 2nd, and 3rd. You can watch all those games on Time Warner Cable Sports Channel. And, of course, next week's games, there'll be games live on the channel as well, streamed at twcsportschannel.com. Guys, it's been a lot of fun.
Yeah.
Thanks for hanging with us and watching football all night long.
You know it.
All right. Coming up next on Time Warner Cable Sports Channel, it's High School Blitz, followed by another game of regional interest coming up at 11:30. For Chris and Dan, I'm Aaron. Thanks for joining us all night long.
I can't think of a better way to end the night with the Hudson Marching Band playing my favorite song, 24-21. Great job, Hudson.